because I'm not a microphone. So you can speak now, NC sir.
Arpit, we should start. It's already 2:08. Arpit.
Hello.
Arpit, start. Arpit. Good afternoon, everyone. Let me welcome all of you this fourth day of Direct Tax Refresher. The expert for the first session, CA Vishal Gada,
welcome you on behalf of the university in the day four of this Friday.
The first technical speaker, CA Vishal Gada, followed with Ketan Dalal ji, and then our elder brother Milind Mehta ji will be taking a session for the day. We have with us our central council member and a very kind personality who always helps us in organizing various activities at WIRC, CA NC Hegde ji. My colleagues in the council, Hitesh Bhai, Arpit Kabra, Murtuja Bhai, and seniors, colleagues and friends, on behalf of WIRC, I welcome all of you in this August gathering. Before I ask my central council member to share his words of wisdom for a couple of minutes, I would like to just share one idea which we are working at WIRC as of now. We have started interactive meet, industry specific interactive meet, wherein we are inviting representatives from the industry from various companies to have elaborated discussion on various aspects of accounting and finance and various compliances, wherein we can take it ahead and we can do some representation jointly or assist them and take care of some of the issues wherein we can engage jointly. So we have started with pharma sector, and we are looking forward to follow with different sectors or different industries. I would request the participants that those who represent any industry, any company, and is really interested to take some of the issues ahead through ICI, please write us at wirc@ici.in so that we can invite you as and when we keep a specific interactive meet. So you can really be part of that and really add value to the overall CA fraternity. With this small remark, I welcome all of you. And now I request our central council member, CA NC Hegde sir, to share his words of wisdom for a couple of minutes. Hegde sir.
You will have to unmute yourself, sir.
Let us continue with the introduction of our learned speaker for the session. I would request my colleague in the council, CA Hitesh Pomal, to formally introduce our expert speaker, please.
Thank you very much, Chairman sir. Very good afternoon, all. Today, CA Vishal Gadaji will share his expertise on the subject of international tax planning in view of GAR. CA Vishal Gada is a partner in Dhruva Advisors and is based in Mumbai. Prior to this, he was with the KPMG. Vishal is a qualified chartered accountant and also completed the business consultancy studies course conducted by Jamnalal Bajaj Institute of Management Studies jointly with the BCAS, and he also holds the Bachelor of Laws degree. Vishal practices in the field of domestic and international taxation with the specific emphasis on the cross-border transactions and regulatory laws with respect to inbound and outbound investments. He also specializes in corporate structuring and family succession and estate duty planning. Vishal has co-authored a couple of books on professional subjects, and he is a regular speaker at various professional forums. He has also been part of various professional committees in the past, namely International Tax Committee of BCAS and Chamber of Tax Consultants, as well as the Research and Publication Committee of WIFC of Chartered Accountants of India. With these, I would like to invite Vishal Gadaji to share his expert knowledge on the subject. Before that, over to you, Arpit.
May I request Vishal ji to please take over the session ahead?
Please, Vishal sir, please.
Yes, thank you. Would I get a link to share my presentation, Arpit?
Yes, Vishal ji. Vishal sir ko presentation to share karne ke liye link bheje. Vishal, did you get it?
Yes, I got it. I'm just uploading my file. Are you able to see my file?
Great. Not yet. It takes a few seconds here.
For my screen.
Yeah, we can see it now.
Okay, great. Thanks a lot, everyone, Lalit ji, chairman and other esteemed members of WIFC. What we'll do today in this short session of 60 minutes, we'll focus on the international tax side of GAR. So I don't think we'll deal a lot with the domestic aspects of GAR. Maybe a couple of minutes we'll refresh the basic framework. But what we'll do is look at certain case studies, certain practical examples as to how in the context of an international transaction, GAR could be an issue, and what is the view which we can take. So I will just spend some time on refreshing the basics of it. As we are all aware, GAR is applicable to arrangements which are regarded as impermissible avoidance arrangement. That's the first part. The second part is that GAR is applicable on or after 1st April 17. And the way the word impermissible avoidance arrangement has been defined is to mean any arrangement the main purpose of which is to obtain a tax benefit. So this is the primary test. This is the main purpose test. If there is any arrangement where the main purpose is not to obtain a tax benefit, we don't have to evaluate any further GAR implications. That particular arrangement will never fall under GAR. But if you conclude that yes, the main purpose is tax benefit, then you have to proceed further to test whether any of the four tainted element test is being satisfied. Even if you satisfy one of the tainted element test, that would result in satisfaction of the main purpose test and satisfaction of the tainted element test. And clearly this arrangement would be regarded as an impermissible avoidance arrangement, thereby leading to attraction of the GAR provisions. And if you look at the four tainted element test, the first test is that the whole arrangement is not at arm's length. Basically, you have done it at a certain value which is not to be regarded as a market value, not to be regarded as the customary arm's length price. The second tainted element test is that the taxpayer has, in the course of carrying out a particular arrangement, misused or abused the provisions of the Act, and we'll of course deal a bit on this. The third tainted element test is that the whole arrangement lacks commercial substance or is deemed to lack commercial substance. There are two limbs. And the fourth is that the manner in which the taxpayer has carried out this arrangement is not something which is ordinary employed for bona fide purpose. And we'll take up an example. So this is the framework of test. You are entering into an arrangement. Arrangement is defined very, very widely, the main purpose of which is to obtain a tax benefit. So let us focus for some time on the term main purpose. What do you mean by the term main purpose? When the finance bill was proposed for the first time to introduce GAR, the draft bill contained the provisions one of the main purposes. But when the finance bill was enacted into the act, the legislature saw it fit to restrict the wordings of one of the main purpose to the main purpose, which clearly means that availing a tax advantage, availing a tax benefit cannot be one of the main purpose, cannot be one of the primary purpose. It has to be the dominant purpose. The second aspect is, you know, what do you mean by tax benefit? And of course, there is a very vast definition of tax benefit, which is given in the provision, which basically says that tax benefit could include deferral of taxes. It could include increase in losses. So it's a very, very wide term. I would, you know, just clarify certain aspects. First is we are talking about tax benefits under the Income Tax Act. So if there is any tax benefit which you are availing, let's say in a foreign country, let's say in the Income Tax Act of UK, in the Income Tax Act of Canada, that's not something which attracts GAR. The concern tax benefit has to be under the income tax in India. If you're doing certain transaction where you have been able to save stamp duty, you have been able to save GST, that again is outside the ambit of the GAR. GAR is purely focused on, are you availing the tax benefit under the Income Tax Act? So that's a very important provision. We also now have this new equalization levy, which has been introduced via the Finance Act 2020. And let us say you are carrying out certain restructuring to eliminate, to reduce, to optimize equalization levy. The said equalization levy is not again a tax under the Income Tax Act. So again, any attempt to reduce equalization levy cannot be brought under the GAR framework. One may look at judicial GAR, one may look at McDowell and other Supreme Court cases, but definitely not GAR. It's very important that the way you will look at whether or not your main purpose was to obtain a tax benefit. And if you look at the international literature, if you look, for instance, specifically at the Australian GAR, there is a concept of a counterfactual. And let me give an example. Let us say you have company B, which has significant losses, and you have company A, which is significantly profit making. And you have merged the profit making company into the loss making company. And the tax office wishes to evaluate whether this particular transaction was the main purpose that to obtain a tax benefit. One of the ways in which we have seen the international tax community evaluate whether or not the main purpose was tax benefit is to apply the counterfactual approach. So while you have merged the profit-making company into the loss-making company, the counterfactual approach would be that what if you would have merged the loss-making company into the profit-making company? And if you would have merged the loss-making company into the profit-making company, and that loss-making company, let's say, would have been a service company, which means the benefit of carry forward of losses may not be available. Can the tax office therefore deduce that prima facie the circumstances suggest that you did a particular action so as to take a tax benefit? And of course, one has to understand that this concept of counterfactual is not enshrined currently under the GAR provisions. But that's something which the courts can look into it in future. I also want to, touch upon a very important point. And the point is that what do you mean by, main purpose? Is the main purpose as important or similar to the motive of the parties? And let me give an example. Let us say the motive of the management is to distribute dividend to all the shareholders in this COVID times. There are significant profits available in the subsidiary. Now, what they do is they merge the subsidiary, which has significant liquidity, into the holding company, and the holding company distributes that dividend. So if you look at the motive of the overall transaction, if you look at the motive of the board of directors, the motive is basically to distribute liquidity, the distribution of dividend. However, what is important is that GAR does not look at the motive. What is your ultimate goal? GAR looks at the objective of the arrangement. Your arrangement was a merger. Your arrangement was a subsidiary merging into the holding company, and thereby you brought the funds there. And GAR will look at whether this arrangement, which is this merger, was carried out with the main purpose of tax benefit. So if your foreign subsidiary were to declare a dividend, and there could be certain tax implications, you know, which would not have been had you merged it, was that your dominant purpose? So it is important that we need to distinguish the purpose of an arrangement with the ultimate motive. A ultimate motive could be maybe that of a non-tax related matter. But if the purpose of the arrangement is tax benefit, that is something which the tax office can bring it under GAR. It's very interesting that while this whole word main purpose in some sense is very subjective, you do have a variety of international literature available. So for instance, I'll just share some aspects which the Australian tax office really decides to deduce whether your main purpose was that of a tax benefit or not. For example, some of the factors which they look into it is the manner in which the scheme was carried out, the form and substance of the scheme, the result achieved by the scheme, if the GAR did not apply to that, any change in the financial tax position of the taxpayer, any change in the financial position of any other person who has any connection. So these are some of the factors which we have seen internationally being applied. And if we were to compare that with our current framework, very interestingly, many of these factors are covered in the tainted element test, which is A, B, C, D, which you can see in front of the screen. So to that extent, I believe we have borrowed heavily from, the foreign literature in order to create a GAR framework. I also want to, share certain examples that there are certain positive factors, which I have seen the US IRS looking into it in order to deduce whether or not GAR can apply. And maybe let me share some very interesting positive factors. The positive factors are where the transaction originates in a non-tax function of the taxpayer. So if the taxpayer can prove that this whole idea of a merger in our hypothetical example was not created in the finance team or the tax team, but was basically done, let's say, in some of your strategy team, in some of your other functions such as manufacturing, etc. That's a positive factor that, tax was never the original motive. The other positive faction is the ultimate decision on whether to undertake the transaction or not was mainly based on non-tax factors. So let us say there is a presentation made to the board of directors, and to the board of directors, the team has shared certain advantages, advantage one, advantage two, advantage three, advantage four. And most of these advantages are not tax advantages. Most of these advantages are business advantages. In that case, one can really deduce that, yes, it's a positive factor that your main purpose was not really, focusing on tax. Let me look at certain negative factors. And the negative factors was that, where the internal documents prepared by your taxpayer prior to the transaction focused exclusively on tax benefits. So let's say you as a tax advisor, you've actually given them a merger proposal highlighting the tax benefits, and that's part of their internal document. Some of these documentations are regarded as negative factors, which can imply that, yes, you do have what you call a prima facie objective of making tax benefit as the predominant purpose of that arrangement. So this is going to be a very, very, I would say, subjective evaluation. Would rely a lot on the documentation, the approach, and of course we will see a lot of jurisprudence being created, and I won't be surprised that the tax courts will borrow heavily from a UK, a South Africa, a US and Australian GAAR codes. And maybe at the fag end of it, we'll also touch upon some decisions, some very interesting decisions recently enunciated by some of these foreign courts. Now, let me very briefly touch upon two matters about it. If you look at Clause A of the tainted element test, creating a transaction at arm's length, I think we all understand, you know, what it is. If something is not at arm's length, that is something which can be questioned. I have a lot of MAT credit. I have a subsidiary. The subsidiary does a slum sale at less than market value because I want to accelerate my MAT credit utilization. You know, absolutely possible that a tax office would say that this is not at arm's length. You are not satisfying the first test. So really, you're getting caught in the tainted element test. Let's look at clause B, which is in my view a very interesting clause, which says misuse or abuse of the provisions of this act. Now, how do you determine whether there is a misuse or an abuse of the provisions of this act? Looks very, very subjective, looks very, very ambiguous. And here, you know, there has been one Supreme Court decision of the Canadian tax law, which basically says is that one needs to look at the policy around a particular provision, basis the documents available, and compare your action vis-a-vis that policy so as to evaluate whether or not there is an abuse of provisions. And let me share one example. Let us say you are a large company, turnover of some 100 crore. You wish to convert yourself into an LLP, but the exemption provisions under Section 47 say that your turnover cannot be more than 60 lakhs in the previous 3 years. So obviously you are not meeting that. So what you basically do it is that you merge your large company into a very small company where you are satisfying that turnover test of the previous 3 years. And then you convert that small company into an LLP. Now here, if you would look at the finance minister's speech where this exemption for conversion was given, the speech very clearly mentioned that we wish to give the benefit of conversion of company into an LLP in a tax exempt manner only to small companies. The manner in which you did convert your large company, though legally right, prima facie looks like an abuse of the policy, abuse of the main objective of the Income Tax Act. So it's quite likely that under the GAAR provisions, this step transaction, merging first into a small company, then converting, may not be regarded as satisfying the second test, and you might be held to be abusing, you know, the dominant intent of Section 47. So that's the second tainted test. Let's look at the third test, which is commercial substance, and it is divided into two parts. One is commercial substance as we naturally mean, and second is certain actions which are deemed to lack commercial substance. And if you look at Section 97, there is a whole lot of list, round tripping of funds, you know, setting up in a jurisdiction where you don't have substance, taking treaty benefit, etc., etc. That's something which may be regarded as lacking commercial substance, and you don't really have to apply the rule of equity. If you fall under some of these transactions, it is deemed that you lack commercial substance. If you do not fall under these transactions, then you have to look at the natural meaning of commercial substance, whether or not you lack commercial substance. And the fourth, which is very interesting, is that have you carried out a certain transaction in a particular manner, which may not be regarded as bona fide? And if you look at the Shom committee gives us one example. It says that, you know, let's say you are a listed company. Let's say currently MAT is applicable, which means you have not opted to be governed by the new corporate tax regime, where you surrender your tax holiday, you don't have to pay MAT. And you are taxed at a concessional tax rate, you have not really opted for it. So you have to pay MAT, you are availing tax holidays, and you have certain shares to sell, and you worry that if you sell it, you will have to pay MAT. So what do? You create an LLP under the listed company, you drop your shares into the listed company, and then that LLP sells it. There is no MAT on the LLP, and the LLP distributes the profits in a tax exempt manner, because share of profit is exempt from MAT. And the Shom committee illustrates this example by saying that, see, the manner in which they have done it, is not something which can be regarded as bona fide. So again, it will depend on facts and specific circumstances, you know, whether you are falling under one of these four tinted element test. But this is going to be a very, very interesting, you know, future for, I would say, GAR litigation. We will see lots and lots of jurisprudence being created on the and the comma and the semicolon of this particular definition. So with that, let's very quickly spend 2 minutes to say that what if my transaction which I'm carrying out is regarded as an impermissible avoidance arrangement, and what are the powers in the hands of the tax office? The powers are wide, you know, they can hang you, they can kill you, they can shoot you, they can put you on fire. So it's a very wide power given by the legislature to the tax office. And some of these are, they can deny treaty benefits, they can recharacterize any step or any of the whole transaction. They can treat as if though this step has not happened, this whole arrangement has not happened. They can disregard certain accommodating parties. And one example of an accommodating party is that where, let's say, your subsidiary has funds, but it can't give you dividend because you will be taxed. So it places that as a deposit with the foreign bank and the foreign bank gives you a loan. In that case, the foreign bank may be regarded as an accommodating party. If there are certain connected persons, certain parties who have helped you do certain tax planning, they can all be regarded as one unit rather than separate taxpayers. Your expenditures, income can be reallocated. Your place of residence can be redetermined. You know, you are trying to take, let's say, the benefit of a particular treaty, the tax office may say, sorry, we will not regard you as a residence of this country. So there are many, many things, you know, and of course, it's very important to know that while the section gives wide ranging powers to the tax office cannot use these powers in an arbitrary manner. There has to be certain logic, there has to be certain equity, there has to be certain balance applied by the tax office, you know, before they really, you know, do this. And let me give one example. We had a very interesting discussion with one of the counsel. The example of a profit-making company being merged into a loss-making company. And we were debating whether can the tax office take a view as if though this merger has not at all happened. And the company which has merged exists separately, you know. And the council very rightly said that no, this entity legally does not exist. There is no question of this entity paying any taxes and filing any tax return. So maybe the tax officer may allow the non-set-off of the losses, etc. That's a very different thing. But the tax officer cannot deem an entity which does not exist. You know, so while there are some powers which says that they can disregard that whole merger, but if that entity does not exist, the tax officer will have to accept the fact that the taxpayer does not exist. And therefore, it will have to do what it has to do with the surviving taxpayer, with the resultant company, with the amalgamated company. So you therefore cannot apply these wide-ranging powers in a very illogical fashion. You have to apply it in a balanced manner. You have to apply it in a logical manner, or the courts will strike it down. Okay, somewhere, I don't know, the screen is not coming properly, but I wanted to talk of the GAR exclusions, and there are a couple of exclusions in GAR. The first exclusion is more like a monetary threshold. It says that if for a particular arrangement, the tax benefit is not exceeding 3 crore rupees in a particular financial year, then you cannot apply GAR. Which means if you do certain small plannings, you know, and the overall benefit is 2 crore, 2.5 crore, the tax officer cannot apply. So that's a nice provision which the legislature has brought in, because they do not want every small transaction to be evaluated under GAR. They really want, you know, certain large transactions only to be evaluated under this new framework. And it is important to note that the calculation of 3 crore itself has variety of issues. So if there are 2 parties, 3 parties involved in an arrangement, you have to combine the tax benefit availed by all the 3 parties and then look at the milestone of 3 crore. If it is exceeding in totality, yes, then this whole arrangement can be covered. The second kind of exclusion which has been given is effectively that FPIs, who are not availing treaty benefits, and let's say who agree to be taxed under 115 AD, they are not taking any exemption under the Mauritius treaty, under the Singapore grandfathering provisions, then those FPIs would be outside the ambit of GAR, because they have agreed that yes, I will not take a treaty benefit for a particular year, and this will be year to year. If in a particular year they do take a treaty benefit, they cannot take exemption. The third exclusion is given to the P notes holder. You know, the investors who hold in the P notes issued by certain FPIs. So it's a non-resident to non-resident transaction. The government has, for a variety of policy reasons, excluded that from the ambit of GAR. And fourth is a grandfathering given, which says that any income arising from the transfer from a security which has been acquired prior to 1st April 2017, you don't have to apply GAR. So let's say I'm a Mauritius company. I, as a Mauritius company, I'm holding shares in an Indian company. My shares were, let's say, invested 10 years back. And the tax office cannot come back to say that, hey, you have set up the Mauritius company only and only for the purpose of availing the treaty benefit, and therefore we will apply GAR and deny you the treaty benefit, because the Mauritius company would be well within its right to say that, see, my investment is grandfathered. My purported income, which is capital gain, is arising from the transfer of my shares, which were invested prior to 1st April 17. So you definitely cannot apply GAR. You may look at certain other avenues such as McDowell, judicial GAR, etc., which would be very difficult to apply to this case, because in some sense, pre-GAR, treaty shopping was blessed by the Supreme Court. But definitely you can't apply GAR. So these are some of the exclusions which are there under GAR. Now we come to the, you know, core of our discussion, which is the whole interplay between GAR and tax treaties, the whole interplay between GAR and international tax planning. And as we discuss, we'll actually take, you know, example by example to really bring home the point that, you know, what's the scenario today? When you have a GAR, you have an MLI, you have a principal purpose test under treaty. So it's a very, very interesting status currently. So very quickly, let me very quickly touch upon this section 90. Section 90 subsection 2 says that to the extent the treaty is more beneficial to the provisions of the act, that would apply. There is also a CBDT circular 333 which brings home that point. But you have a subsection 2A which simply says that notwithstanding the fact that treaty to the extent they are beneficial compared to the provisions of the Income Tax Act will apply, the provisions of Chapter 10A, which is basically the GAR provisions, shall continue to apply. So there is a clear treaty override provided under the domestic tax law. There is no ambiguity. Clearly, subsection 2A says that the GAR provisions will have an overriding effect over the treaty provisions if required. You know, there is a contradictory argument to say that under the Vienna Convention, you have to apply treaty in good faith. There cannot be a domestic override. There is a view available, you know, but I don't think that view is very dominant. We understand many countries agree with the fact that the domestic provisions can override the treaty provisions, you know, if that is legally constituted, if the constitution provides that, if that particular domestic statute provides that. US, for instance, for donkey's years used to take a view that my domestic legislations would always override the provisions of a treaty if I wish to be. So even the European countries, which are basically parties to the Vienna Convention or part of OECD, many countries take a view that yes, the domestic provisions would rule supreme over the treaty provisions. And therefore, I'm not surprised that, you know, the way Article 26 of the Vienna Convention is read in a very diluted manner. And it does not provide for a treaty override on the domestic provisions. Very interestingly, when we look at certain specific treaties, Singapore, Spain, Indonesia, Luxembourg, they specifically provide that the current treaty will not impact your domestic provisions, you know, to the extent you have certain anti-abuse provisions therein. So certain, and in my view, this is clarificatory. It's not that if a particular treaty does not have such a provision, you can argue that the treaty kind of overrides the GAR. Not at all. These provisions under some of these treaties merely clarify that the domestic countries have a right to bring in their own domestic anti-abuse provisions such as GAR, which can override the treaty benefit. You know, this is pretty interesting. If you look at a treaty itself, the treaty itself today has, and this is post MLI, post multilateral instrument, you know, being in effect. And as you are aware, from 1st April 2020, many treaties have come into effect with the MLI provisions. If you look at some of these treaties, they itself have many anti-avoidance measures. There is a title, there is a preamble which says that the treaty is not intended to encourage double non-taxation, what you call a treaty shopping. There is a LOB clause, a limitation of benefit clause, which brings down a variety of objective tests in order to exclude treaty benefits in certain circumstances. Most important, there is a principal purpose test, which I think India has adopted in most of its tax treaties, which basically goes, I would say, in fact, beyond what GAR applies. GAR says the main purpose, the dominant purpose, if it's tax benefit, you know, you can really disallow the tax benefit. Principal purpose test says if one of the principal purpose of the arrangement is to obtain treaty benefits, the treaty benefits would be denied. And interestingly, there is no grandfathering under the PPT test. You know, old treaties, old investments, everything can be covered under the PPT test. So PPT test, in fact, I would say in some respect is wider than GAR. Then you have, you know, the age-old beneficial ownership test, which used to be there in certain source-based taxation articles, interest, royalty, fees for technical services, dividend, where the total withholding was capped provided the recipient is the beneficial owner. If the recipient was not the beneficial owner, that cap in the tax rates, in the tax withholding was not allowed. Now the question is, if treaties have so much of anti-abuse provisions, why do you need a GAR? Now there was a question which was put up into the CBDT circular, that in spite of such detailed LOB test, which is the anti-abuse provisions in the GAR, in the treaty, will GAR still apply? And of course, the way they responded is that in case, if such an avoidance, such a tax avoidance is sufficiently addressed by the LOB clause in the treaty, there shall not be an occasion to invoke GAR. Look at the wordings. There shall not be an occasion to invoke GAR. So I do not think the CBDT is agreeing. The circular is agreeing. No question about it. It says that GAR can still apply. But if the anti-abuse provisions under the treaty was significantly wider, you know, then maybe there may not be an occasion. We may choose not to apply GAR. So that's pretty important, you know. The next question is that, you know, how do you look at the interplay between GAR and PPT? I'm very sorry, there is some formatting issues I'm finding on the screen while the document is a PowerPoint. So bear with me. For some reason, the title is coming at the bottom. But the contents are properly legible. I hope so. You know, if this issue continues, I might try to load a PDF once again. Right now, I've loaded a PPT. But let's continue. You know, the one very important point is the interplay between GAR and PPT, which in my view will be at the heart of international tax planning. If you look at the principal purpose test, as I earlier mentioned, it clearly said that if one of the principal purpose was a treaty benefit, you know, you would be denied treaty benefit. But the principal purpose test also has an exclusion, which basically says that even if one of your principal purpose was to avail treaty benefit for any reason, if it is established that giving such a treaty benefit is in accordance with the object and purpose of the relevant provisions of the tax treaty, then okay, we will not apply the principal purpose test. So there is what you call a reasonable purpose test, which is a question of fact, which is whether or not one of the principal purpose was to avail treaty benefit. And then there is a object and purpose test, which is a question of law, that even if one of the principal purpose was to avail treaty benefit, maybe the treaty partner still intended to give you that benefit. And we'll actually take one example to bring home the point as to in what example you can use this to come out of what you call the principal purpose test. And see, if you were to look at the comparison between GAR and PPT, it's very interesting. As I mentioned, GAR says the dominant purpose, the main purpose, has to be a tax benefit. Principal purpose test, even one of the principal purpose could be tax benefit. You know, so in that sense, it's pretty wide. The consequence under GAR, as we discussed, are very wide. You know, they can recharacterize a transaction, reallocate an income, deny treaty benefit, ignore accommodating parties, merge your connected persons, very, very wide. Whereas the impact under MLI, under the PPT test, is they can deny treaty benefit, as simple as that. Here, the onus is on the tax authority. So is the case, I would say, with the PPT test. There are certain administrative safeguards which have been provided for GAR. So you need the involvement of an approving panel before you can really initiate GAR. Whereas in case of a principal purpose test, you're at the mercy of the tax officer. If a tax officer agrees, basis his best interpretation of the PPT, that you have not really violated it, great. You get the benefit, or you are in for a very long litigation. There is a de minimis threshold of 3 crore benefit under GAR. So GAR does not apply to small transactions, small plannings. Principal purpose test, absolutely no de minimis threshold. 1 rupee of treaty benefit, you do not satisfy the PPT test, treaty benefits are denied. And there are no grandfathering. See, the biggest issue with PPT is that old investments are also covered. Even old investments can be challenged under the tax treaty. Whereas in case of a GAR, new investments, any investments made on or after 1/4/2017, those are the investments which are covered under the GAR. So you do have some kind of a grandfathering, which I think is a significant relief. Now let's look at one example where we are able to really look at the interplay between a GAR and the PPT. And let's look at this Singapore test. What I'll do, if you can give me a minute, because the diagrams are not being shown properly. So can I really put my PDF instead of a PPT? Would you be okay with that?
Yes, sir, please go ahead.
Okay, so I will just convert this PPT quickly into PDF so that we have the right diagrams before the audience. I will just excuse for 2 minutes and I'll very quickly come back. And I might request for a link maybe again to, yes.
So that would take time. Maybe what we can do is we can share the PPT. We can host it on our website again. So people could, maybe take notes now and then probably download it and maybe see
the structure. Okay, perfectly fine. My apologies, why the diagram is not coming properly, but let's look at this. Let's look at this structure where you have a USA company. USA company has invested in a Singapore company and Singapore company has invested in the Indian company. And this investment in the Indian company has been made prior to 1st April 17. So these are the facts, So you basically have Singapore company as a intermediate company, and really the purpose was to take benefits of the India-Singapore tax treaty without any doubt. Whereas the parent company, the original company, the home country is really in USA. And, the Singapore company is transferring certain shares in April 2019, which is the previous year, and it wishes to transfer certain shares in the current year. And what is the significance of these 2 dates? GAR is applicable for last year, GAR is applicable for this year, but the principal purpose test, the MLI provisions, they have only come into effect in the current year. They were not applicable in the previous year. So why don't we see the whole applicability of GAR to the sale of these 2 shares? Look at the first transaction, which is happening in the previous year. GAR is applicable, PPT is not applicable because the MLI provisions didn't come into effect last year. In terms of GAR, you are getting a clear grandfathering, because if you sell the shares, there is a capital gain. The tax officer is not allowed to get into the inquiry of whether the Singapore company was interposed to take the treaty benefit. No, why? Because your investments are prior to 1st April 17. So absolutely, GAR exclusion is there. And in terms of PPT, because the MLI provisions were not applicable last year, no question of denying the tax treaty. So you are safe as regards the sale of shares which the Singapore company made in the previous financial year, which is financial year 2019-2020. Now, what happens to the transaction you make in the current year? The transaction you make in the current year clearly again has a GAAR grandfathering, because again, these are shares which you had acquired prior to 1st April 17. So really doesn't matter. You are absolutely safe under the domestic laws. But PPT is applicable. MLI is applicable. So are you satisfying the PPT test? And as I mentioned to you, let's presume that the main purpose or one of the main purpose of investment was to avail the treaty benefit under the India-Singapore tax treaty. In that case, there are three views which arise under the PPT test. The first view is that PPT is not applicable since DTAA contains specific provisions for grandfathering past investment. So very interestingly, even in the India-Singapore tax treaty, there is a grandfathering provision which says that capital gains tax exemption would be applicable for investments made prior to 1st April 17. The grandfathering, mind you, is not for non-applicability of PPT. So in the domestic law, the grandfathering is for non-applicability of DAAR. In the treaty, the grandfathering is only for the capital gains tax exemption. If you look at the PPT test applies. But that's the first view, that because there is a specific grandfathering for capital gains tax exemption, you should not apply PPT. The second view is that no, PPT overrides the capital gains tax article, and therefore the PPT clause is applicable, and therefore you should deny treaty benefits. So both view one and view two, they are on the two extremes. And view three says that, see, while PPT applies, which means you should test PPT, even though there is a grandfathering, the fact that the two countries came together and they said that we will not levy capital gains tax on old investments, it should be covering in the exclusion given to the PPT. You know, the provisions which we read that in spite of PPT applying, if it can be proved that it would be with the intention of the treaty, with the objects of the treaty partners to give the benefit, then you should not apply PPT. And in my personal view, it is arguable that view three applies. So PPT applies because PPT clearly overrides every article of the tax treaty. But it seems to be a fit case that because the two countries specifically agree that yes, we should come together and give certainty to the old investments, we should come together and kind of, you know, exempt capital gains tax for old investments, you should carve yourself out from the exception given in the PPT, which says that it should be in tune with the objects of the treaty partners to give this benefit. So I personally believe that while view three has a ting of litigation, view three seems to be a more balanced view in this. So this is how you have kind of, you know, mixed the applicability of GAAR and PPT and actually looked at grandfathering both under the treaty and under the domestic tax law. So it's a very, very interesting scenario. Now, let me skip certain slides because, you know, we might have only, you know, we started at 2:10, we should close by 3:10. There are other two sessions. So I'll try to, you know, quickly look at some good examples in the next 15-20 minutes. But the whole focus of GAAR applicability in the context of international tax planning will be to deny treaty benefits, which means that in the context of GAAR, a tax officer will look at characterizing a particular transaction mainly for treaty benefits, mainly for treaty shopping. So they will look at a couple of tests such as commercial substance. And as I mentioned, there are certain deemed commercial substance tests under Section 97. First test is that involvement of the residence of a party without any substantial commercial purpose other than obtaining a tax benefit. So let's say if I were to form a company in Netherlands, because Netherlands has certain tax benefits, non-resident to non-resident is exempt. There is a lower withholding tax. I do get the benefit of MFN, but I'm not able to demonstrate the commercial reason why I'm setting up in Netherlands. Is it that you know, my management is based in Netherlands. Is it that I am getting a great financing because I am based in Netherlands? In that case, I may not be able to argue as to why did I choose Netherlands as the place of residence. So that could be deemed as lacking commercial substance. No significant effect upon business risks or net cash flows. You know, again, if what I'm doing is just setting up one entity which has no capital of its own, everything is backed up by my parent company. So it's just like a paper company, which is really not taking any business risk. There is no significant net cash flows. Again, you know, that entity could be attacked from a domestic guard perspective, denying the commercial substance. So this is going to be the whole focus of a couple of other case studies, which we will see in the context of international tax planning. Let's look at, you know, the first transaction, which basically is about, debt equity mix. So you have a France, of course, is the parent company. France is not an intermediate company. And let us say France has infused 90 rupees as CCD and 10 rupee as equity in the Indian company. And let's presume that they have taken care of the thin cap rules, which are there currently under the domestic tax law. And in spite of that, you know, the France entity is able to avail deduction of interest expenditure. The question is that what could be the potential exposure in such a structure? If I am a tax officer, I would say that the main purpose of infusing the CCD was to avail the deduction. You have a 5% withholding tax rate, so you also wanted to avail that 5% tax rate. I would argue that your capital structure is not at arm's length, because nobody will have 90% debt and 10% capital, etc. So these could be the revenues contentions. Whereas my contention would be that, see, FAQ 3 of CBDT says that GAR should not interplay with the right to choose a particular method. If I have decided that France is the right company to invest into India, France is the parent company, India has some great business opportunities, how I invest should not be your concern. So if I've put in the capital in the form of equity, in the form of debt, that choice should be given to me. That could be my argument as a taxpayer. Second argument I would make is that you cannot equate equity and debt. Debt has regular cash flows in the form of interest. Whereas in equity, I will get an upside. So I have chosen, you know, what proportion I want debt and what proportion I want as equity. I would say that I pay dividend only and only on the equity portion, not on the debt portion, which is CCD. There is already a thin cap. It's at arm's length. Section 94B I'm complying with. So you can't really apply GAR once more. And I have applied CCD because, you know, maybe I can sell those CCDs tomorrow to a potential investor who might have a preference for a fixed coupon rather than taking risks on the equity instrument. So these could be some arguments which I could build. And of course, it will all depend on facts and cases. But a precise example like this was taken in the Schoen committee report. And I thought the committee report was in favor that in such a case, you should not apply the GAR provision. You should give liberty to the taxpayer to kind of determine its debt portion. And of course, the ICO has to come up with some prima facie logical reason why it has kind of brought in that kind of a debt and that kind of an equity per se. So that's one example. But let's look at a scenario where the tax office really recharacterizes this instrument as an equity instrument. In that case, it can disallow the interest and it can treat it as a dividend. So today, the interest which I pay on the CCD was clearly allowable to me as an expenditure. Under the treaty, I was deducting tax at 5%, but it will now disallow. And therefore, I as an Indian company would not be able to take any deduction of it. This is, of course, provided GAR applies. The interesting question is that if GAR is applicable on the Indian company and it is treated as a dividend for the purposes of my domestic tax return, and therefore that interest is not allowable, for the purposes of my recipient parent company which is getting that interest, can the tax office disallow that interest, treat it as a dividend, and maybe apply a different rate of withholding tax if at all there is one? Now, in that context, we interestingly had this CBDT circular, and the circular is saying that corresponding adjustment will not be made. So merely because I have applied GAR in the hands of the Indian company, that does not mean that I will recharacterize that instrument back in the hands of my French company. My French company would treat it as interest. It would be eligible for the relevant withholding tax rate. And this corresponding adjustment would not be carried out. Now, this is, a welcome clarification, which is there in the circular. So it's only the Indian company which will suffer the consequences of GAR. But of course, my personal view, also backed in the Schoen committee report, there could be multiple of factors which you can demonstrate that you have the right to choose your debt equity mix. Let's look at the second transaction. This is a case where you have interposed a UAE company. So you are an Indian company. Instead of investing directly into the Netherlands company, you have interposed a Dubai company. Dubai company has then invested into the Netherlands company, and Dubai company has invested in the Netherlands company mainly by way of a loan and partly by way of equity. Whatever interest is paid by the Netherlands company comes in the Dubai company. It is not taxable. And the Dubai company, if at all it wishes to distribute that money back, would distribute back as dividend, because the Indian company has invested in the Dubai company completely as equity. There is no loan between India and Dubai company. Also, because of the favorable tax regime of foreign dividends, the dividend which will come to the Indian company would be taxed at 15%, not at 25% or whatever be the corporate tax rate of that company. Whereas if the Indian company had directly given a loan to the Netherlands company and Netherlands would have paid an interest to the Indian company would be maybe paying tax on that interest at the highest rate available, depending on its corporate tax rate. So here the issue is that can the tax office come back to say that, hey, you have interposed Dubai only and only to ensure that the interest which comes from Netherlands is recharacterized as dividend. There is no other purpose. And again, the taxpayer would be required to demonstrate why has it formed a company in Dubai? Why does it want to form an IHC? Are there any strategic reasons? Have you documented that strategic reason? Are there good amount of people, 4-5 senior people sitting in Dubai, which can direct your European operations? Do you back-to-back distribute that fund every time it comes, or you are using that money in Dubai so that you can expand further and invest in new subsidiaries? So these could be some of the rationale to defend against GAR. But if you are doing a back-to-back distribution every time Netherlands declares a dividend and interest and everything comes back to India, Dubai entity lacks substance, then I won't be surprised that the tax office may trigger GAR, ignore the Dubai entity altogether and treat as if though that interest and dividend is being directly received by the Indian company. And therefore, you have to build up a case. And in my view, in one of the cases, what we have seen is we got a counsel view which said that really if those funds are conserved in Dubai, they are not immediately distributed. Those funds are conserved for future investments. Sometimes you might distribute the dividend back to the Indian company, but that's not a regular feature. That itself would prove that you are creating an IHC to conserve value, to kind of keep the fund so that you can make further investments. That could be some prima facie defense against applicability of GAR. Let's take this example, which is the choice principle. A foreign company wants to invest in India. So it has invested in a company and it has invested in an LLP. Actually, historically, it had invested in a company. Thereafter, it said that, let me also invest in an LLP. Then you had the lowering of the tax rates. So company today, unless you declare a dividend, company today is taxed at 25%. This EFCO coincidentally, let's say, is France. So, you know, the dividend withholding tax rate is just 5%. So even if you were to pay a dividend withholding, you realize that for you, a company is a better structure compared to an LLP structure. And so what the foreign company is doing is that it is giving less work to the Indian LLP and it is giving more work to the Indian company. And can the tax office comes back to say that, hey, what are you doing? You know, you are doing deliberately so that you have more profits in the Indian company where the tax rate is less. And therefore, you know, I would ignore this subcontracting and I would presume that this subcontracting is continued to be made to the Indian LLP. I do not think that action by the tax office is permissible. You know, you can probably argue that it's a business decision by the parent company, whom does it wishes to give birth. That's something which cannot be questioned under GAAP. You do not have the right to presume the subcontracting work being done by the Indian LLP, if at all. You know, the Indian company has carried out that subcontracting. You do not have the right to allocate the income between the India and the LLP. And I would believe you can build in substantial defense to ensure that no GAAR applies, because it's primarily a business decision. Where do I wish to give work? Do I wish to give more work to the Indian company or do I wish to give more work to the Indian LLP? Let's take one more case study of indirect transfers. As you are aware, you know, there is a view and a strong view that indirect transfers, though taxable under Section 9 of the domestic tax law, they are not taxable under the treaty. Of course, you have certain observations in the recent advance ruling of Tiger Global in the context of Flipkart. But you have many, many high courts, etc., which have taken a positive view, such as Sanofi and others. The whole question is that to take the benefit of indirect transfer under treaty, you have to create a twin layer of companies in the foreign company. So if you're, let's say, investing via Singapore, and today, if Singapore were to invest in India, there is absolutely no treaty benefit available in terms of capital gains tax. So you invest in Singapore company two. So there is a Singapore company one, there is a Singapore company two, and that Singapore company two invests back into the Indian company. And tomorrow, if you were to sell the shares, you will sell the shares of Singapore company two. You will not sell the shares directly of the Indian company. And today, can the tax office argue that, wait a minute, your whole purpose of creating a twin structure was to ensure that the indirect transfer provisions under the domestic tax law does not apply. And therefore, you know, you are trying to avail a treaty benefit. Now, this is interesting. In my view, this could be a real razor's edge. Unless you are able to demonstrate that S2 is not formed merely for the Indian company, but maybe you are also, you know, carrying out certain other activity and there are a couple of other investments, it might be a bit difficult to argue that the purpose of putting S2 was something other than taking benefit of the indirect transfer. So this, of course, is a very, very sensitive issue in most international tax structuring, that if you create a twin structure, how would you demonstrate that this is the reason of creating? And in my view, many, many structures which we have evaluated, you know, they are absolutely sitting ducks for the tax office to apply GAAR or to apply the MLI test under the treaty to kind of deny the treaty benefits. Let me skip a couple of examples because I might have to wind up in 5-10 minutes. Let's look at this interesting case study of transfer of IPR. You have this recent case of Delhi High Court, you know, where what happened was ACO had licensed, you know, the IPR, and, you know, before transferring that IPR to a foreign company, they had kind of terminated the license agreement. Then they sold, and then that new company kind of entered into a fresh license. This is very similar to the Pfizer ruling, which we had many, many years back, almost 10 years back. So here you have a parent company in Australia. It has granted an exclusive license to the Indian company to sell more products. Subsequently, you know, ACO wishes to transfer the shares of the Indian company, and it also wishes to transfer the IPR to the UK company. It sees that there could be an exposure that because the IPRs are being used in India, the situs of those IPRs could be held to be in India. That itself is a matter of debate, but basis certain decisions, the Australian company feels there is a tax exposure. So what it does is that it cancels the agreement it then gives that license to the buyer, and buyer then gives the license to the Indian company. That's the first step. And the second step is then it also transfers the shares of the Indian company. And the whole issue again is that was the main purpose of termination of the brand licensing agreement, was the main purpose so that, you know, you can sell the shares and that UK company can again give a license back to the Indian company? And in my view, if the UK company is again doing a back-to-back licensing, you know, without any commercial purpose, I think it would be seen as that the step of transferring this whole idea was nothing but to ensure that, you know, you don't pay any taxes in India on the transfer of IPRs by the Australian company to the UK company. But if the UK company is then giving that license, not just to India, but to variety of other companies, one may argue that, you know, this was a simpliciter sale of IPR, and maybe UK company wanted a clean IPR. It didn't wanted any other, you know, I would say prior agreement. It didn't prefer an assignment of agreement. What if UK company wanted to renegotiate the IPR license? So if today ICO is paying, let's say, 2% to the Australian company, and the UK company says that I want to charge 2.5%, so you please cancel that, sell that IPR to me, and then I will renegotiate with the Indian company basis certain business you know, discussions. In that case, maybe it can build up a case. But if simpliciter same arrangement happens, you know, one can really debate whether, you know, there could be an exposure. So you have to create certain new business conditions. You have to create certain new business rates before which this transfer of IPR can be outside the GAR ambit. Let's take one more example. And this is a very interesting example done multiple times in the past. Indian company has a Mauritius company. Mauritius company has invested into the shares of the UK company. Mauritius company has now sold the shares of the UK company. There is significant funds lying in the Mauritius company. The Indian company now wishes to take the funds back. So it has two options. One is Mauritius company declares a dividend and the Indian company pays a dividend. The second option is that, you know, Mauritius company gets merged into, you know, what you call the Indian company. And if Mauritius company merges in the Indian company, there is no taxability subject to the GAR. As you are aware, Mauritius has not chosen MLI in the context of India-Mauritius treaty. So in any case, we don't have to really worry about India-Mauritius treaty, MLI, and nothing of that sort, because Mauritius has not chosen India for that purpose. So India-Mauritius treaty continues to be without the MLI, without the PPT purpose. And the question is that if this happens, how would you defend, you know, under GAR? You know, let me put some thoughts. One thought is that you decided to wind up Mauritius company. And the way to wind up is to do a simpliciter liquidation, to, you know, maybe get the Mauritius, declare the dividend back, and then sell the Mauritius company because now it's an empty entity, or maybe to merge it. Can you argue that if my dominant purpose is to wind up Mauritius company, whether I liquidate or whether I merge it, that choice should be given to the taxpayer under FAQ 3 of CBDT circular? Second is, there is a predominant thought, and in fact, even the Shom committee report said that certain transactions which are under NCLT, under High Court, where a regulator has blessed it, should be whitelisted for the purpose of GAR. So if there is a merger happening, the tax officer should not be given an authority to second out the transaction. But of course, that was a recommendation of the Shom committee. It never saw the light of the day. But I do believe that if it's a NCLT approved merger, if your dominant purpose was to wind up, maybe you might be able to come up with a theory to say that, you know, hey, the main purpose was winding up the operations. And therefore, the way I wind up should be left to me. I have decided to merge it. There is another way to argue that even if the dominant purpose, the main purpose is regarded to not pay tax on the dividend, so you have failed the first test. What about the other four tests? First is the arm's length test. In a merger, you will satisfy that. Second is, are you abusing law? But that's a window available under the Income Tax Act where specifically mergers are exempt. if I've taken support under that window, you can't argue that I have abused the merger window. So I do not think the tax office would be right in applying the second tainted test. The third is a substance test. Now, typically in a merger where everything is coming back in the Indian company and I'm not creating a Mauritius company, those tests could be irrelevant. The fourth test is that, am I doing certain things which are not normally done, which are not done in a bona fide manner? And in my view, a cross-border merger cannot be regarded as something which is not bona fide. This is something which happens, you know, I would say quite occasionally. So even from a second angle, even if you fail on the dominant test, I do think you can build up certain arguments in the tainted test. I think, Arpit, I am short of time, isn't it? So should I just go to one or two decisions of the Canadian Supreme Court and conclude this talk? Sorry, I can't hear you, Arpit. No, somehow I'm not able to hear. So why don't I? Yes, Arpit, yes. Sorry. Arpit, should I just conclude in 2 minutes, go to those one or two foreign decisions? Yes, because there are many examples in between. This PPT can be put up on the website.
So we will do that.
So let me
hold little properly because I think it's a PDF, so we cannot see the screen appropriately. So if you like, for example, if you want to show the slide 36, we can see half of 35 and half of 36.
No, I know. I don't know why it is happening, because this is a PPT which I have uploaded and even I am able to see. So there seems to be some problem with the PPT.
No problem.
Maybe next time I will do a PDF. Very sorry for this.
No problem, sir. So 2 minutes, maybe if you can conclude, we've got other speakers also waiting.
I will just touch upon this one Canadian federal court decision. This was a decision where, let me just summarize the principles. Let me not get into the mechanics. So here the federal court said that you have satisfied the anti-abuse provision under the treaty, and therefore we would not allow the tax officer to apply the domestic guard. So this was a very interesting decision where the taxpayer won at the federal court level, where the basic underlying principle was that if you have satisfied the LOB or the anti-abuse rule of a particular treaty, or the object of the treaty is to give you benefit, then that's it. You don't really have to look further. To my mind, seems to me a bit liberal provision, because if you apply this in the context of every treaty, then the GAR could become redundant. But at the same time, you have this principle being put up, you know, by a foreign court. At the same time, you had, you know, one more decision, again of the Canadian court, which was given, I would say, way back in 1997, where they basically took the purpose test to say that, no, so what if you are satisfying the treaty test, the overall steps what you carried out and the speed at which you carried it out and the time difference which was there between different steps seems to suggest that you wanted to take benefit of the treaty, and therefore we will not allow you the treaty benefit applying the domestic guard. So with the same country, which is Canada, you actually have two decisions. Of course, the federal court is a higher court and that decision is a recent decision. But I just thought, you know, this whole debate about you satisfying the tests under a treaty which will influence non-applicability of GAR, that is something which in my view is likely to continue for the years to come. So with this, why don't I conclude, you know, my talk here. Thanks a lot for a patient hearing. Very sorry for this formatting issue of a PPT. Maybe I'll learn how to do it next time. That's it, Arpit, from my side. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Vishal bhai. And I must tell you, being a student of international tax myself, you know, a very insightful session, and the structure and every other arrangement that you talked about, really, they've been very good and very helpful. I'm sure all of the entire audience would have felt very good about knowing this, learning this. So we've got some questions. The four questions, if you could take them. The first one is, does it relate to AR decision in case of Tiger Global Management selling shares of Flipkart, the one that you spoke about?
No, I have not deliberately taken any case study for two reasons. Very interestingly, you know, unlike the normal presumption that in the AAR, the AAR held that treaty benefits are not available, actually the AAR refused to admit that application, saying that prima facie this is a tax avoidance. and therefore I refuse to admit the application. So in my view, whether treaty benefits are available or not, that's something still is likely to be contested. So I've not really taken that case study in any of my presentation. So second issue is that whether GAR can be, yes.
No problem, sir. If you can read it,
I'll read it. Yeah.
No problem.
Perfect. Whether GAR can be invoked on CCDs issued in 2011 and converted in equity in 2019, or shelter can be taken under the grandfathering rule. This is very interesting. The CBDT FAQ covers this, saying that even if an instrument has been converted into equity after 1st April 17, it should still be regarded as being invested prior to 1st April 17. So that's a welcome clarification. In the absence of that CBDT, I think you would have had some debate. But I would like to believe that yes, such a CCD, which is now an equity, should arguably still be subject to the benefit of the grandfathering rule. Third question is that in my example of debt equity mix, in case there is interest moratorium in the initial years, what would be the arguments available to Indian company from a GAR perspective? See, what happens is an interest moratorium is not a very uncommon respect. This is done because of, let's say, lack of profits, you know, the financial conditions not being very strong. And I would like to believe that even a lender, you know, would give you moratorium. And therefore, your argument that I have invested in the interest instrument or in the CCD instrument, you know, with a very different purpose, with a very different risk structure, should still be good under GAR. Of course, your arm's length becomes an important point, which is one of the tainted tests. But before the tainted test, I would say the tax officer will have to cross the first primary motive test. And as the Shom committee report rightly says, it might be difficult for a tax office to break the debt equity structure of a company because the company would come up with some very good reasoning as to why it did that. And the last question is whether GAR can be invoked on CCD issued in 2011 and converted into equity. I just gave an answer that no, this will be regarded as an instrument on which grandfathering is available. That should be a good view. I think the courts would hold that. So you should be able to take grandfathering benefit and GAR should not be invoked on that instrument.
Okay, Subhav, I think, yes, if these come into play, it will be a lot of relief for many of us who are looking for an insight in you know, long drawn litigation already that are about to happen.
Sure.
Thank you, Vishal bhai, for this insightful session. I now declare the first session over, and I first request for word of thanks, I'll request Anand Jakhotia, the treasurer of WIRC, to please join us for a well deserved word of thanks for a brilliant session by Vishal.
Thank you, Subhav.
I think he's having an issue there. Man, may I request Balkishan, our regional council member, if we can join him. Balkishan ji?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. May I request you to please give word of thanks for the first session? We have closed our first session. Vishal ji is with us.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, Arpit. And we are very thankful to CA Vishal Gada, sir, for taking that session very nicely. And we are also very thankful to all the participants. And thank you very much, sir. Yeah.
Vishal, thanks a lot. Please share the PPT so that we can share for the, you know, betterment, and we can share with the audience here. Now I request, so we have another tall personality with us and a name to reckon with in taxation. Ketan Bhai is here with us, Ketan Dalal ji, and also I have one of our dynamic Central Council members along with us, Dheeraj Khandelwal ji. I mean, he's someone who's always just a phone call, in fact, now just a WhatsApp message away, and is always there for our help. May I request Dheeraj Bhai to please join us in the panel. Sir, if you can just switch on your camera also. Welcome, Ketan bhai. Good afternoon, sir. Sir, we are not able to hear you. Maybe if you are on mute. Sir, you are on mute, sir. Dheeraj sir, can you hear me? Kedan bhai, you are on mute. No, no, we are not able to hear you, sir. Sorry. Mishra ji, can you please check with Kedan sir? I think if there is some issue that he is facing, sir, may I request you to just log out and log in again? Maybe it may just work. Right.
Hello, Kedan sir. Wait.
Yes. हाँ माशा मिश्रा जी बोलिए.
केसर केतन सर का आवाज
है. केतन सर का आवाज नहीं आ रहा मिश्रा जी, बस जस्ट चेक कर लीजिए प्लीज.
हेलो केतन सर. हेलो केतन सर.
हाँ उनको अपनी आवाज जा रही है पर आपको आवाज नहीं आएगी. मैं रिक्वेस्ट धीरज सर इफ ही कैन हियर अस, मे बी इफ ही कैन अनम्यूट हिमसेल्फ.
हाँ भाई.
धीरू भाई, यस यू आर देयर.
ओके.
Can you hear us?
Yes, yes, I can hear you.
Perfect. Mishra ji, can you please check up for Ketan sir's logistics, maybe if you can hear him properly, or if not possible, maybe if you can quickly do a log out and log in again, so that we'll get this sound correct. And in the meantime, friends, as I said, one of our most resourceful and one of the dynamic Central Council members who's always there for our call, in fact, just a message away. That sir, we need your help in something, and today he's there with us. Sir, thank you for joining. Welcome to DTRC, the flagship program of WIRC, and we are very happy to have you here. We've got around 2,500 plus registration, and you know the audience is here, and we would like to hear from you. Maybe your opening remarks or your keynote address, but you know you're resourceful, and we would like to have more and more from you. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Arpit. Thank you, Balkishan, and the speaker over here. I think in this COVID-19 situations, the topic it is M&A in the COVID-19 situation. Everyone's feeling that nothing is happening, everything is locked down. But we have heard the news of Reliance and Facebook, who has agreed to have a deal where the Facebook will acquire 9.9% of the Jio platform, and that this will give a opportunity to Facebook to enter the Indian market, as well as going to benefit for the Reliance, Reliance also, and this will also benefit to the consumer as they will get the better services. Further, we also know that there's an exponential increase compliance for the companies, be it the company law, be it income tax, be it in the GST, etc. So a lot of compliances are there, and in that compliances we need to think about whether all the companies are being in the group, you know, small companies are there, whether to have a one company or merge company and single entity. That is also being in this COVID-19 situation are the think of the other people. Merger acquisitions are the way to go forward. Even our CA firms have been going for mergers to pool their resources and to take the advantage of economics of scale. Client also benefiting by this, and so on. That's going to be different benefits for the having CA mergers between the firms. Now the role of the chartered accountant in merger acquisitions have become very important. After introduction of the concept of registered valuer under the IBB, IBBI, as CA has to take up and to attend specialized classes and pass the CA exam, only then CA are eligible for becoming a valuation of very different instruments, be it a equity share, be it a debenture, preferential or debenture. As of now, in the IBBI, around 1,200 members have been registered for this as a registered valuer. So there also valuation purpose, a lot of M&A purpose valuation need to be done. And in terms, if I say that every merger acquisitions need a registered valuer to carry out valuation goals. So we want to use this platform to engage young chartered accountant to research for the research valuation. And I can say that in this COVID-19 situations everywhere, whether I just mentioned, we have seen the Reliance case that, you know, in the last 3 months, we did number of, you know, merger acquisitions, and everywhere the needs per se, requirement per se, merger acquisitions are happening. And this is a apt topic in this current COVID-19, how we need to cope up and what are the integrities are there in the in this M&A, what are transactions we have to look on, what income tax X will be applicable, what are the transactions to be checked in the M&A. It's very, very important, because now for everywhere we have to have see that a merger acquisition is going to happen, and whether COVID-19 situations are there or not there. And this thing's going to be on the regular basis. And this is a topic, and I believe that the speakers are there. He will give us a more enlightened way about how the tax perspective to be taken care of in the M&A deal. And with this, I wish all the participants, it's a happy learning. And I also congratulate the WIC team, Arpit and Balkisan, both are the young leader, are taking very passionate way of working, and really congratulate for having a number of participants in this series. Thank you, Arpit, and thank you, Balkisan.
Thank you, Dhirubhai, and congratulations for you for making a great course in this public accounting series that you've done. And I'm sure every committee that you've been working, you have turned it around and you have made it so relevant for all the chartered accountants. Look forward to for some more sessions on government accounting and public accounting. I think the first course that was launched, there was Full House. So, you know, there's a lot of demand of that. And with you at the helm of this committee, I'm sure we'll do a lot more. And, you know, please do share insights on that. Maybe one day, if you can take out some time and share with us, for the audience, that, you know, largely about more insight on this public accounting body, we'll be more than happy, sir. And thank you for your
time. Thank you, sir.
Friends, here we had dynamic chair, central council member Dhirubhai, fondly called Dhirubhai, Dhiraj Khandelwal, sir, of course. Now, Ketan, sir, we are ready to hear you. One of the legendary personalities in taxation that we know and we are aware of. But as required, we'll do a small little introduction for sir before we start with the session. Sir, we are good with your logistics, right? Yeah, if you can just say
well, I can you hear me now?
Okay. Perfect. Clear. Okay, I'll request now regional council member from Surat, Balkishan ji, to please introduce Ketan bhai in the best manner, so that, you know, we can start off with the session immediately.
Yeah, thank you very much, Arpit. Ketan sir is a veteran with 40 years of experience in cross-border tax issues and investment structuring, including merger and acquisition. He was the joint head tax All India and the managing partner, and was a member of the India leadership team with PwC India. He exited the PwC in April 2017 to pursue his independent professional interests, and runs a boutique structure and tax firm, Catalyst Advisors LLP. He is a member of the managing committee and the chairman of direct tax committee of IMC. In addition to having been a member of several SEBI committees, such as SEBI's High Powered Advisory Committee, he was also a member of the working group on non-resident taxation, formed by India's Ministry of Finance in the year 2003. International Tax Review, a leading global magazine on international tax, has listed him amongst India's leading tax advisors. So, members, we present you before the leading speaker of India, CA Ketan Dalal, sir. Yes, sir.
Ketan bhai, thank you. Thank you for accepting our invitation and, you know, coming over here in DTRC. I think on M&A, we really have a great speaker in you. Under the leadership of CA Lalit Bajaj, Chairman WIRC, we really heartily welcome you, and over to you.
Thank you, Balkishan. Thank you, Arpit. So what I will do is, we are at about 3:40. So I think Arpit will have till about 4:30 to take about 50 Thanks, minutes. Sir. Is that okay? All right. So what I've done is I have put together about 22, 23 slides, which has about 11 case studies, because it's always easier to understand from a case study format. So that is what I think we'll do. Inevitably, we are all obviously tired of hearing about COVID, but the topic itself is mergers and acquisitions in view of COVID. So I thought it would be useful to first just set out, what is happening to the economy very briefly on COVID, what are the sectors impacted? Because my belief is, friends, that unlike in the case of a pure tax topic, so Vishal, for example, was talking about international tax and GAR. Unlike in that situation, M&A in India particularly is a very integrated animal. You cannot do M&A just by looking at tax. You can't say ki section 50B mein slum sale hai, 56 mein ye hai. You have to understand what the SEBI regulations are if you're a listed company. You have to understand that in Maharashtra, the stamp duty cap has been increased from 25 to 50 crores. You have to understand what are the FDI non-debt rules and so on and so forth. So unless you do that, that integration is not there. The second issue is commercially, and Tanvi, you can go to the first slide. Commercially also, you see the M&A is driven obviously by commercial reasons. It is not driven by tax reasons. Because it is driven by commercial reasons, we have to understand commercial imperative. So with that, broadly, let's go to the first slide. I am not changing that slide, so I don't know why it's, oh yeah, there it is.
Okay. Request, Tanvi, yes.
She'll do it now. Yeah. So I think so we are
yes, sir. So we are there in the background, just switching off our webcam, but we are there wrong. So anytime sure. you want, no just problem, no problem. A short
way. Yeah. That's fine. So I think we are obviously in the midst. I think Shakti Kantada said this very well. This is one of the biggest health and economic crises in the history of the world. We have massive global and domestic disruption. And this is linked to the M&A topic, obviously, and that is why I'm bringing that up. You see, regardless of the fact that business operations have started, there is a fear in our mind about COVID, which is the reason why many of us are attending office, alternate days or lesser hours and taking all sorts of precaution. Now imagine if this is happening to us, imagine what is happening in factories. Imagine the situation of hotels and restaurants is too well known for me to say. But I think the bottom line is there is a substantial slowdown of economic activity, substantial disruption of supply chains, and the demand has collapsed. I think this is one of the biggest issues. So for example, somebody who's running a massive QSR restaurant, he said, Ketan, will you go to my outlet with your grandson? I said, no, not for the next 6 months, maybe not for the next 1 year. So there are all these issues, and they are linked with M&A, because I think there will be consolidation, there will be deals which are happening. What may happen is that the erstwhile hotel may be sold now to a hospital chain so that they can convert it. The bottom line is deals will happen. The second issue, which is the second box at the bottom, is the credit crisis. We have serious cash flow issues and NPA issues. And the cash flow issues mean that the paradigm of M&A deals in the context of COVID will change. What do I mean by that? That earlier the situation was, okay, I want to sell, you want to buy. In most cases, I get paid for my shares of my business and I give you the shares of the business. Now, the situation of swaps of shares, redeemable preference shares, deferred payment terms will come, and that will create a whole lot of tax issues. The third dimension is business valuations. This is more a commercial issue, but that commercial issue will also be need to be linked up with 50D and 50C. So it's a whole set of issues around this. So let's go to the next slide. I did mention about several sectors being impacted. So this is a nice slide. So we don't want to spend too much time on it, but it's a nice slide made by a consulting organization called Avalon, which you see the acknowledgement at the bottom, that they divided the businesses or the sectors into three categories. The first is low impact. The second is medium impact, and third is high impact. I don't want to actually go into each of them, but we all know that sectors like retail, restaurants, hotels, airlines, real estate, media, sports. Now imagine a Virat Kohli playing to an audience which does not exist in the stadium. Imagine a concert to be played with an audience which does not exist. And what will it happen to the sale of tickets? What will happen to the televised rights? I mean, it will impact everything. You know, it's not easy to say that, you know, the stadium is empty, but you can see it on the TV. What will happen to Wimbledon matches? And these are all commercial things. So some IPL teams may be sold. Now, these are the kind of M&A issues that will happen. Let's go to the next one. Before we get to the technicals, last one or two slides. An ENY study showed that 58% of companies are planning a divestment in the next 6 to 8 months. Now, that doesn't mean the company will be sold. Maybe a business will be sold. Maybe 58% is out of a particular sample. The 58 may be 40, maybe 45. But the bottom line is, I think serious amount of M&A activity is likely to happen over the next 6 to 9 months or the foreseeable future, maybe the next 1 year. And this obviously means that there will be a need for structuring advice. The second aspect is, as I mentioned it, valuation is a challenge because a promoter's expectations on valuation before 15th March should logically be very different from his expectation today, but it may not necessarily be. So therefore, matching that expectation on buyer-seller is an issue. And along with the valuation, there is an expectation of upfront cash because the seller will say, look, I'm in need of money. That's why I'm selling. Now, if you're deferring it, how do I do this? So there'll be all sorts of funding structures, upfront cash, discounting, all sorts of things like that. And we need to understand this in order to give holistic M&A advice. You can't just do it with tax, as I said. The third box below talks about sectoral dimension. So for example, NBFC issues, RERA issues, those kind of things we need to bear in mind. There have been some regulatory relaxation. So for example, the pricing of preferential issue. Somebody may make a preferential issue in order to fund the company so that he can make an acquisition. So instead of the last 26 weeks, it is now the last 12 weeks because prices of the last 26 weeks may not reflect today's reality. But there are, of course, very tricky tax hurdles, and most of you are aware of those. I will come to that in the course of the case studies, Section 56, Section 50A, Section 50D, GAR, all sorts of 219AA, all sorts of things. So let's move forward. You know, I have for many years, and last 15 or 20 years, I've done, you know, reasonable amount of work on the M&A structuring part. And in my mind, I have come out with what I put on the screen there, which I call the CRT formula. C for commercial, R for regulations, T for tax and fiscal. The most important I've realized from experience is that commercial imperatives will always drive business decisions. I have a call with a counsel on a major family settlement matter at 5 o'clock today, and I know that there is a risk. And the client is saying, take the view of the counsel. And I said, I know that the counsel will say there is a risk, but at the end of the day, is your commercial imperative strong enough for you to take the tax risk? It's a decision I can't take. It's a decision you have to take, but I know there is a risk. Then regulations get intertwined. Company law. So for example, Section 185, 186, provisions on dividend, provisions on mergers and acquisitions under 230, 232, etc. You have Ind AS. So for example, in M&A, one or two of the most important Ind AS provisions are Ind AS 109 for financial instruments and Ind AS 103 for business combinations. Because unless you look at how the balance sheet and accounting will look for the buyer and the seller, it's an incomplete review. You have FEMA issues, you have SEBI issues, you have competition commission issues. I spoke already about sector-specific laws. Then you have income tax, GST, you know, transition, for example, of GST in a merger, stamp duty, and so on and so forth. I won't go into each of them. Suffice it to say, as I said, it's an integrated approach that is necessary and not a siloed approach on tax. Okay, let's go to the next slide. I did speak briefly about this, but, you know, if you see in the last 5-7 years, I think that there is the birth of what I call the dual trinity. So there is a tax trinity and there is a regulatory trinity. So tax trinity is GAAR, recently changes on dividend taxation, changes in capital gain. So for example, you have grandfathering of shares, listed company shares purchased on or before 31st January 2018, for example. Then there are deeming fiction, there is POEM, etc. So that's the tax trinity. On the regulatory trinity, instead of High Court, you have NCLT, you have amendments in the Companies Act for restriction on layered structures. Then I already mentioned about Ind AS, and I think the more I look at these structures, the more I'm realizing that the complexity of Ind AS is something which many people ignore. And then when the transaction goes forward and the client says, oh, but I understand that this is my CFO told me that this is the way it will look, and you never told me, because if it looks this way, then I'm not sure I'm comfortable with it. So please don't ignore Ind AS. And then, you know, as I said, you have RERA, NBFC, IBC, and variety of provisions. So I think the birth of these dual trinities has complicated the matter immensely. You know, we talk about ease of doing business. I'm sorry to say, I don't think there is any ease of doing business. It's a very, very complex regime, unfortunately. So it is what it is, but we have to deal with it. So let's go forward. So what is the need and objective of M&A structuring? And of course, I'm linking it with COVID, as the blob in the bottom says. As I already mentioned, COVID has exposed business to new challenges, you know, cash flow strains, losses in one, profits in another, you know, long credit cycles, NPAs, variety of things. So in that context, while the M&A needs are common at any point in time, they have to be what I call COVID customized currently. So you may have to rationalize existing structures to ring fence businesses from risk. Let me explain this. We are looking at a financial service sector company where there is a funding business and a non-funding business, and the promoters are extremely worried that they want to ring fence the funding and the non-funding business because they believe that the funding business obviously has greater risk. And if that greater risk comes to fruition, for example, there are a lot of NPAs, it can drag down the whole business, including the highly lucrative non-funding business. And therefore, there is a thought process of splitting up that entity. Now, that's easier said than done, because you know, you have lenders in the funding business who says, look, if you do this, it's a truncated business, and I'm not sure I'm agreeable to this, because remember, creditors' consent is required. You know, you have shareholders. If it's a listed company, you have analysts, you have newspapers, you have perception, you have all sorts of things there. Then facilitating transactions. So for example, I mentioned that a report said that 50 to 60% of businesses are looking at and open to potential divestments. But in order to facilitate the transaction, the structure of the company must be good enough for the divestment to be made. So for example, we have a situation where a very large bungalow is sitting in an operating entity. It's a 400 crore bungalow sitting in a 1,000 crore entity. Now, if you want to sell the business in the form of shares, you can't sell it with the bungalow because that's your personal bungalow and it has been leased out to you by the company as a perquisite. So you have to prepare for that in advance, and sometimes time will run out, and therefore the earlier done the better. Then you may want to simplify group structures, let's say for cost reduction. So you may merge two or three companies so as to rationalize cost, because as I mentioned, one is cash flow and second is cost is critical in any point of time, and currently much more so. Review of holding structures, you may, for a variety of reasons, so I won't go into each of this bullet, but some of it will come back. And balance sheet, you may want to right size because you may have a loss, and that loss, some of that loss may be due to COVID, maybe messing the look of your balance sheet, and you may just want to right size it so that it is like a liposuction of a balance sheet. Let's say by writing off the P&L account, again, the share premium under a scheme, capital reduction scheme under Section 66 of the Companies Act, for example. So this is an example of restructuring. Some of these are external M&As. So with that, let's go to the next slide. So this is probably the right time to mention this, that in this 11 case studies, we are talking of two different things. You know, One is internal group restructuring and shareholding structure. So for example, I mentioned about splitting that company into two parts. That's an example of internal group restructuring, although of course there are external stakeholders involved as well. And then there is external M&A structuring. So you want to sell the company, you want to sell the business. So there are various triggers. We will not go into each of them. Some of these are common, some of these I've mentioned, but many of this, you know, we will talk about as we go forward. So let's move forward. So let's with that come to the first case study of internal group restructuring. So let's say you're seeing that slide, and on the top of the slide, you're seeing that there is an ICO with three businesses, business A, B, and C. The C, which is in red, is the business which needs to be delinked. And there could be a variety of reasons. So let's say it's a riskier business. Okay. Now, what are the tax issues and what are the other issues in the delinking? So first, let's look at how will you delink? What are the options for delinking? One, and you can't, you don't have the money, or you don't have the ability, sorry, that you don't have the ability to sell it externally. And let's say you want to keep that business C also, at least for the time being. One way of the delinking is what I call a vertical delinking, which is on the bottom left of the slide in front of you. So you will see an ICO, you will see a NewCo, and you drop down the business C. A classic example, a recent example, a big example of this is what I understand Piramal Pharma is doing. And that is in the context of a potential transaction with where a private equity will invest. It's currently sitting in Piramal Enterprise. You drop down into a separate company and then somebody buys into it. The second way of delinking is what I call a parallel deal. This is a vertical delinking. That's a parallel. The one on the right of your screen is what I call a parallel delinking. So you, there you have an ICO with business A and B, but unlike in the case of the vertical delinking, the NewCo is parallel. Now that parallel is usually achieved by a demerger. And let's come to what are the options and what are the issues in the next slide. So let's say it's a demerger. So in a demerger, you will have a transfer of track record. You will have business contracts going much more easily. But the transfer of tax losses is also possible. So let's say business C has tax losses. So the transfer of tax losses attributable to that business is possible. Very importantly, in the case of a demerger, you can have an appointed date with this retrospective or prospective. So today we are on the 11th of July. Many of the demergers that are happening today are having the retrospective appointed date of April 1, 2020, because in your balance sheet and profit and loss account of March 21, you want a clean cut situation and not a messy situation, part of the year this and part of the year that. The other advantage is that there is no cash consideration in a demerger because you're splitting the shares and the shareholders get shares in both companies. On the downside, you have an NCLT process, 5-7 month time frame, and if it's a listed company, then you have a much more elongated process. But let me just take you through a couple of tax issues in the case of a demerger. One of the issues is that while there is a tax neutrality of a demerger, it assumes that several conditions are satisfied. One of the conditions is that shares are issued to the shareholders of the demerged company. The shares are issued by the resulting company to the shareholders of the demerged company. The second, and this is very, very tricky, there should be an undertaking which is being demerged. Now, sometimes doubts may arise, is this an undertaking? Let's say if there are common borrowings, let's say if there are common facilities, let's say a boiler is common. Those are the kind of issues that can arise, and I really wish CBDT would clarify all this, that you know that a view that will be taken will be a business view and not an ultra technical view. But from our point of view, and many of you are in practice and some of you are in industry, and both of us in our own ways advise our clients or our employers, we have to be extremely careful that at least you have done the reasonable due diligence that what you're demerging is an undertaking. Now, in case study, which we just took up and which is the context of this slide, we are just talking of a business. But imagine if business C also had a subsidiary company, let's say it's chemicals, and it had another subsidiary below business C, and the subsidiary is also moving along with it. then can you say that the business and the shares in the subsidiary should be an undertaking? I would think so. I would think so if the business is the same. But if the business is 100 crores and the value of the subsidiary is 2000 crores, then you might have some kind of a challenge and say, oh, is this an undertaking or is this not an undertaking? So these are the kind of issues. Now, in a slump sale, can you first of all do it at book value? Because if you're doing a vertical delinking and there is no monetization event today, you may not want to pay tax currently, because although 47 exempts it, if you are going to do a monetization in 2 years, you will not satisfy that 8-year condition. So the question is, can you do a slump sale at a book value? Answer is yes. I don't think there is an issue with it. I don't think 56 will apply to it, because 56-210 does not apply to a business undertaking. So you can't impute a face value. It's not like a 50C kind of situation where you have a deeming fiction. And I think I don't think it's a loophole. I think it's a very rational provision. The issue with a slump sale is that unless the slump sale itself is done under a scheme, it can be prospective and not retrospective. But obviously, it is much simpler to carry out in terms of time and in terms of paperwork and in terms of some of the issues like undertaking. So it is much simpler as compared to the demerger option. But the demerger option has a parallel advantage as opposed to this kind of a structure, which you may not necessarily want. Okay, let's move forward. Case study two. Now, this is a sort of somewhat like an extension in one sense of case study one, but with a very important nuance. So let's look at the chart. You have ICO and you have a WOS of an ICO. Now, let's say the WOS has a business C and you want to dealing business C, and some part of that kind of business. Let's take the same example of chemicals. So let's say the wholly owned subsidiary has a turnover of 2000 crores and it is in chemicals of a particular type, say specialty chemicals, and the generic chemicals, let's say 300 crores, is sitting in ICO. And now you want to dealing the chemical business from ICO, because ICO has got pharma, which is large, and only 300 crores of chemical, and the majority of the chemical is sitting in the subsidiary, which is the WOS in this chart. Now, one way to do it is that ICO can demerge the business, the generic chemicals business, along with the shares in the subsidiary, along with the share, into the WOS. That means the shares of WOS are demerged into WOS and get cancelled, because it is the shares in the WOS itself you are demerging. The consequence of that structure and Adani Enterprise, many of the companies have been created as a result of this kind of a structure and a scheme of arrangement some years back. The resultant structure, if you do this, is what is given on the bottom left, which is the ICO and the ICO 2. The ICO 2 will have business C and the generic chemicals business, which has come from ICO. I think this is a good structure if you want to do it. The problem is that it does resolve to some extent the issue of demerging a wholly owned subsidiary. But if ICO has a very nominal business, say 5 crore chemical business, then it could be hit by GAR, to my mind. And they say, oh, but actually ICO really didn't have anything. There was nothing of substance. And you demerge the subsidiary. Of course, you still have an argument that shares in a 100% subsidiary should be considered as an undertaking. I honestly don't know why it cannot be considered. In fact, I personally had conversations with CBDT. Some of them seem to agree, but I said, look, nobody is going to believe this till you make it clear in the law. If you believe it is clear, at least issue a CBDT circular, because you don't need them to amend the law. They've not done it. But in the situation in case study two, where I gave an example of 300 crores and 2000 crores, I think it should be okay. It has been done in, as I said, in Adani, Thomas Cook, Quest Corporation, etc. And I think it should be okay. But will you have some risk of litigation? That I don't think you can rule that out. And as I said, I wish the CBDT comes up with some circular. So, by the way, small finance banks have also done this. They've dropped the business from the Topco. I'm not talking about case study two, but case study one. The drop down has been done by small finance banks also, to dropping down at book value. Because in a small finance bank or a payment bank, you can't have other businesses in it. So the business is needed to be delinked for regulatory purposes. Let's move further into case study three. So case study three, as the title clearly says, is, let's say you have two businesses in the group, business company A and company B. Company B is having tax losses and you want to merge company B into A to take advantage of the losses. Let's say company B is an NBFC, okay? And company A is in something else in financial services, okay? And let's say the regulations are not hostile to that merger happening. Let's assume that that is possible under the regulatory framework. The issue is that if B does not satisfy an industrial undertaking requirement, then the losses of B will not be allowed in A. Let me give you an example. I think many years back, much before ILFS got into the problem it got, there were some potential transactions. And one of the issues, not the only issue, one of the issues was that if ILFS had substantial losses, if that were to merge into another financial service company, the losses would not go exactly what I mentioned in the case of B and A. So I first of all, I think the law needs to be amended, because the original presumption that losses can arise more in a manufacturing company and how can service companies and other companies have losses is something which is a 30-year-old thought. Today you have the majority of the losses have been incurred in non-manufacturing companies. I mean, we took the example of ILFS, we have Reliance CDAG Group, we have DHFL, you have so many other entities where losses have come in non-manufacturing entities, and this is a major deterrent to deals because the losses are not allowed in the context of a potential merger. But let's say here we are talking of a group merger, or even a non-group merger for that matter. But thinking of a group merger first, one possibility is then A could merge into B rather than B merging into A. And I don't think GAR should apply because it's a commercial decision. But there could be non-tax issues in this. So for example, let's say the lenders of A will be uncomfortable and say, I don't want to merge with B because it's a loss-making company. And unless you convince me that the loss will not happen in the future or is unlikely to happen in the future, I'm not going to give my creditors consent. The second issue is the capital structure of B may get messed up, of the merged company may get messed up. So B may have, let's say, debit balances of profit and loss account. That debit balance in the course of the merger could be set off against share capital or share premium and the balance sheet right-sized. So those kind of issues can happen. But the possibility of B, the losses of B and A being set off could work if A merges into B. An alternative which comes as the last blob on the right side, that if for some reason you want to merge B into A, could you consider a demerger, but the demerger envisions that B has two businesses, because if it has only one business and the whole business is sought to be demerged, forget tax, the NCLT will say, but what are you demerging from? There is no business in B other than what you're demerging. So therefore you can't, we are not willing to even sanction the scheme. So the regional director, the ROC and the NCLT could potentially take that view, and therefore that could be what I call an execution risk, forget a tax risk. But if B has a business and not like a 1 crore business, so let's say it's a 500 crore business which you're demerging, and there is a 20 crore business sitting in B, and that hopefully has been shown in the segmental accounts or the management and discussion and analysis, and it may be a sub-segment of that business, okay, then the demerger from B could be another potential you could think of, which may be simpler than merging A to B. So these are the kind of issues that can arise in this. But I think these two possibilities are there, i.e. what I call a reverse merger, or B, a credible demerger from company B into company A, with B retaining one reasonable size division. What is reasonable size has to be seen on a case by case. Okay, this is a interesting one, and it's a situation in which we ran into a regulatory problem, a shareholder approval problem, and haven't been able to solve it now. Nobody ever envisioned it, but let me tell you what the matter is first. So promoters have holdco. and Holdco has a listco below. So Holdco is a, let's say, a holding company of the family. Okay, now for a variety of reasons, promoter intend to hold the shares of listco directly. Now one reason could be that there could be a family settlement taking place at the top level, there could be a potential divestment taking place at the top level, there could be some dividend reasons, whatever the reasons are. In such an event, can the holdco be collapsed into the listco? And let's say the holdco has only one asset, and that is the shares of the listco, and it has, let's say, a 5 lakh bank balance, just to take an example. Now I think the holdco merging into the listco is the best option, and that under the definition of amalgamation is of course tax neutral. The listco will issue shares to the promoters to the extent of the value it holds plus the 5 lakhs rupees of cash balance it holds. So the swap ratio will not move the needle of promoter holding by more than a minuscule percentage. So this can be done. Surprisingly, in the case of Ajanta Pharma, the Bombay NCLT, in a, how should I put it, strange decision, disallowed this on the basis that there could be a GAR issue. What could be the GAR issue? The GAR issue could be, in the view of the NCLT, that if the holdco had sold the shares of the listco, then the dividending out would be a tax cost. And the reason the promoters wanted to collapse is that they wanted to save that. And the, it was argued that, look, but we have no sale in mind. How can you take such a view? Be that as it may, that situation was rejected. Subsequent decisions in the case of Godrej Industries, NIIT, have been allowed by NCLT. So Ajanta Pharma, in some sense, as sort of, I won't use the word overruled, but somewhere gone into the background. But it's important that you, as the participants of this, I thought I should tell you that there is such a situation. The other tax issue here, and then I'll come to an important SEBI issue. The tax issue, which is the one in red. You see, Holdco is holding the shares of listco. And if Holdco sells the shares of listco, there is a grandfathering because it can take the value of the listco shares as on 31st of January 2018. And therefore, if it sells, so let's say that price was 100 and the price today is, say, 60, and the sale is for, say, 80, then you will not pay any tax because the grandfather cost was 100. But now you will lose the grandfathering. Why? Because when Holdco merges into listco, the cost is relevant to the promoter's cost of holding Holdco, regardless of the Holdco's cost of holding listco. This is a very, very, very tricky tax issue, which you have to be very cognizant of. And therefore, you have to think, is it worth doing the fold up or is it not worth doing the fold up? And again, it will depend on a case to case situation. So this is a major tax issue, as I said. The other issue is box number three. You see, technically, although in my example here, it is only 5 lakhs worth of additional thing, the remaining is just shares getting cancelled. But technically, a promoter company is getting merged into a listed company. Now, the SEBI circular of 10th March 2017, which deals with schemes of arrangement, mentions that if a public company, if a unlisted promoter company is getting merged into a public listed company, which is the case here, then you require the approval of the shareholders, majority of minority shareholding, by excluding the promoter. So let's say promoter holding is 65%. So out of the 35, those who are voting, it could be e-voting. So let's assume all are voting, just for sake of simplicity. So the normal situation would be 51%. If it is special resolution, it is 75%. But here it is, 18%, because 18 is more than half of 35, because the promoter holding is 65%. Now, remember, majority of the shareholders do not vote. I don't vote, for example. What happens is that if a shareholder is holding 5-7%, he could hold up the whole merger, which is what actually has happened in one of the matters I'm aware of. He just held back, for no rhyme or reason. I held it back. I mean, you can't prevent such a thing to happen. And therefore, you have to be extremely careful with this majority or minority. And this is what I'm trying to tell you. It is not just a tax issue. It is also an execution issue. It is also a regulatory issue. And you need to intertwine and integrate these issues to come up with a solution, as opposed to looking at it in silos. You cannot look at it in silos. Okay, then there are some stamp duty issues and all, but I think it'll get too much in terms of time, so I won't go into all that. Let's go to the next case study. So here I just want to point out that, you know, the dividend distribution tax has gone, but of course there is a tax on dividend distribution in the hands of the shareholders. There are different tax rates depending on whether you are a resident or non-resident, company or non-company. So here we are just trying to see that, let's assume that you are looking to extract money out of the company because in the COVID situation, the promoters need the funds. Maybe they need the funds to pump into another company from a profitable company. So here what I'm trying to say is that if the distributable income, and we are now talking about the table in the middle of the slide, if the distributable income is 100, let's look at only the first three columns. Let's forget the non-residents. In the dividend option, if the promoters are individuals, at the top, then 36% rate. If it's a company, 25% rate. And if it's a firm or an LLP, 35% rate. As against that, the buyback is a 23% rate. So I think in a COVID kind of situation where you are in a hurry to extract funds, where, you know, you're just not willing to go through anything more complicated and you're willing to pay the tax, you could look at this possibility as opposed to dividending it out. Of course, will they look at variety of other options? Can that company give a loan? Is section 185, section 222E? I mean, we have to customize all those issues, but this is just a plain vanilla point. It's just one point, again, a regulatory point. In the case of a buyback, you don't require an NCLT approval, provided you are within the parameters of section, I think, 68 now. The old section of the 1956 Act was section 77A. But the buyback has got restrictions and threshold limitations, which is 25% of paid up capital and free reserves. So I'm assuming that the distributable income, or what you want to extract, the 100 rupees, is less than 25% of paid up capital reserves. But I think this is just an important dimension you need to bear in mind. Can apply, by the way, also to listed companies and not just to this. But remember, in a listed company, you know, who takes advantage of the buyback, who doesn't, etc., can create shareholding misalignments. Okay. I did refer to this briefly about balance sheet cleaning up. So let's say you are wanting to potentially sell a company in the next 6-9 months, but the company, while it's doing a bit better, is still under stress, but it has old accumulated losses through, and it is showing up in the profit and loss account. But from earlier good times, you have, let's say, a securities premium, you have a general reserve, you have a capital redemption reserve, you have a capital reserve, etc., etc. So you may want to do what I call a balance sheet right sizing or a cleanup, and, so to speak, dress up the bride or the groom for the wedding to happen 6 months later, i.e. the divestment. So one possibility is a cleanup scheme under section 66. Now you can do it under 230, 232, read with 66, or you can do it only under 66. I won't go into the nuances of that, except that there are variety of precedents, Future Consumer, DataSoft, SoftGene, Trigen Technologies. There are lots of precedents on that. So I think it's an important dimension. I just want to link it up with one more thing, that you can do a merger and a cleanup at the same time. So X merges into Y, Y gets cleaned up, etc., etc. And you can achieve both of those. There has been a recent decision. I forgot the name. I think last week some decision. I forgot the name. It was in Tax Sutra, BCA Journal, etc. That if you do a downsizing of capital by writing off the capital, you will not get a capital loss. There are earlier decisions that if you do get some money for the shares and you write off the balance, that could be considered as a transfer. So I think those are also the kind of issues that you will have to customize. This is not the right forum to go into that complexity, but I wanted to point out that important tax issue. You obviously have to contend with what will happen under Ind AS, etc. I'm not going into all that, But I thought the purpose of this case study in the COVID time that we are in, that this balance sheet cleanup, I think, will become an important dimension. And you can, as I said, combine it with a couple of other things as well. Remember, this is a 5 to 6 month process. If it is an unlisted company, obviously simpler. If it's a listed company, more complicated. Okay, let's go further. So now there are some examples of external M&A, although we did try and mix up some elements of external M&A also into this. So this is a situation where a company A has a chemical business, a company B has a chemical and a pharma business, and company B is intending to divest the chemical business to company A, and company A is not willing to pay money right away. Is willing to go through a demerger and issue shares, but company A says, I cannot issue equity shares, I can issue you preference shares. And company B is desperate, so it is even willing to look at that possibility. So let's look at the regulatory and tax issues. First of all, when you demerge the chemical business of company B into company A and preference shares are issued, can that be considered as tax neutral demerger compliant under section 219AA? The answer to that is clearly yes, because the conditionality of section 219AA is that shares must be issued to the shareholders of the demerged company. Now the shareholders of the demerged company are M and N, the demerged company is B, and the resulting company, which is A, is issuing shares, albeit preference shares, but that should not be an issue. The second issue is 3/4 of the value of the shareholders, 3/4 in value of the shareholders of the demerged company, which is company B, which is M and N, must become shareholders of the resulting company. Now the preference shares are issued, they have become shareholders. It does not specify a time duration, but one issue is that if the preference share, as let's say, for want of another example, immediately, let's say I take an extreme example that it is redeemable in, say, 3 months, then there could be a GAR issue. Then the tax officer could say, you have said you are issuing shares, but on a substance over form you are paying cash. But let's say if it is 1 year, if it is 9 months, then it's not that easy to say that, because remember, the shareholders of B are taking huge commercial risk that their preference shares will be redeemed. So I think it is tax neutral unless it's a very short period. So I would urge you, don't have that short period. Of course, M&N must agree to that. Remember, M&N are taking risks of redemption, both in terms of regulation that A will have the profits, and B that it will actually redeem. If it is a listed company, of course, there are some variety of other issues. I won't go into that. In a listed company, something similar has been done by Alembic a few years back in the real estate undertaking demerger. So there are precedents of this nature also. This is an example of an external M&A transaction having happened through a demerger, but because in the COVID kind of situation, we are building in the variant or the nuance of preference shares as opposed to equity shares. Suppose these had been normal times, and let's say it was intended still to be a demerger. Then it could have gone into A could have issued part preference shares, part even given cash. It would not have been a tax neutral demerger. But here I'm assuming that A does not have the money, at least currently, and therefore is wanting to issue only preference shares, and B shareholders are willing for that, reluctantly willing, but willing. Okay, let's move on to case study 8. Okay, case study 8 is again a COVID kind of nuance. So let's say there is a seller company with division 1 in green and division 2 in red. The red is the one which you want to sell, and you have an acquirer company. So in the normal situation, acquirer company would have acquired division 2 presumably on slump sale basis and paid cash. But now it does not have the full cash. So it is wanting to give cash plus shares. Now if it gives cash plus shares, then it cannot be considered as a slump exchange, because remember, there are some judicial precedents. So for example, you have Bharat Bijli's case, where a slump exchange was not considered to be a slump sale, and therefore no tax thereon. But if you pay part shares and part cash, then it cannot be considered to be a slump sale, and you will pay tax on it. So there will be a tax element on the seller company, even though it is receiving, it is not receiving full cash, but it will pay tax on the full cash because some value will be imputed to the shares. And I'm not going into the details of that, but it will be liable to tax. On the buyer company, incidentally, I did mention about Ind AS and Ind AS 103, the excess of the payment which is made over and above the book value should be considered as something on which depreciation should be allowed, even if it is classified as goodwill. But I would only urge that if possible, break up their goodwill into, let's say, brands, if there are brands, let's say customer relationships, let's say mining rights, and so on and so forth, so that the controversy on goodwill becomes lower. Remember, in Smith Securities, the goodwill even on an amalgamation has been allowed, because in an amalgamation, and I think rightly so held, it's like, instead of paying you money, I paid you shares. How does it matter, you know? But what I'm trying to say, goodwill can be broken up into the elements of goodwill, that controversy will become lesser. So you may just want to consider that. Of course, then you have to do a valuation, a purchase price allocation, even within goodwill, etc. But it may be worth doing that in the context of getting, if I would say, not tax certainty, but less tax uncertainty. Okay, case study number 9. Yeah, so this is a situation where there is a distressed holdco, and there is a closely held company which is below that, and the whole reason the holdco is distressed is it is having a very it's having a loss making company. So in that, just a minute, I'll have to get a charger, so 1 second, just give me. Sorry. They are willing to buy the company when they get the benefit of the losses, and the proposition for consideration is, can we do the acquisition at the holdco level? Because then at least the registered shareholder is not changing. That's a tricky one, because in the situation of buying the distressed holdco, first of all, the buyer may not be willing to buy, but if he wants the losses, then that one possibility is there of arguing that the registered owner continues to remain the holdco even after the acquisition, and therefore it should be allowed. Now, there is a variety of case laws, I'm looking at them, that if there is no change in registered ownership, which there are two decisions that I could locate at least, which says that the loss should be allowed. One is Yum Restaurant, and second is Tainwala Trading. But there are also negative decisions, CLP Power, Vadwa and Company, MCO Power System. So you need to be careful. The one additional tax dimension is that if there is unabsorbed depreciation in the closely held holdco, then the 79 condition does not apply, because 79 applies only to brought forward loss and does not apply to brought forward. Does not apply to the unabsorbed depreciation. Okay, let's go further. You know, again, in the COVID situation, there is a lot of pressure on cash flows, but it is a pressure not only for the seller but also for a potential buyer. So there are deals in the pipeline which talk of deferred consideration or sometimes even contingent consideration. So look at this slide. So the selling company is saying, I will merge and I will issue NCRPS. It is somewhat similar to the structure that we had said, except that it was a demerger, here it's a merger, etc. So for the buyers, there is no immediate cash outflow. But for the sellers who need money in this market, if they get an NCRPS, non-convertible redeemable preference shares, then they would be liable to tax as a result of this when the shares get redeemed and there is no immediate cash coming in. But this is a possibility. Of course, there is a risk to the sellers that what if the RPS is not redeemed, somewhat similar to what I had mentioned in the demerger thing. One important hurdle that I want to point out is that if the shareholders to whom NCRPS issued are foreign shareholders, then this is a problem, because NCRPS is considered to be external commercial borrowing, and therefore it, unless RBI approves, this will not be a possibility if the sharing shareholders are foreign shareholders, which is a situation we faced. Okay, the reason I put down this deferred and definite is because I want to also link up the situation with contingent versus deferred, which is in the next slide. So this is an important slide. I'll finish in the next 5 minutes. We need to understand the difference between deferred and contingent, because that is a significant tax impact. A contingent consideration is situation where, as you will appreciate, that you are not sure of that consideration. For example, the buyer says that if the EBITDA is X rupees, then you will get 10% extra or 20% extra. However, a deferred consideration is where it is fixed, but the time is deferred. In the contingent, the time and the possibility are both deferred. Now, the tax issue is that although capital gain, let's say it's the transfer of shares, although capital gains is leviable on the transfer of a capital asset and the transfer has taken place at a point in time, you don't even know the full value of the consideration in a contingent consideration. And therefore, whether the contingent consideration, because by the time the assessment comes, you will know it. Can he take it? I don't think he can take it. The only issue, and the Bombay High Court in the case of Hemal Raju Shete has held that. I think the language in the documents is very important, of course, and so are the real facts. But the important issue is in the next year, there is no transfer of a capital asset. So there is a possibility that you may consider that as business income or income from other sources, and the rate of tax may change. So that's a very important aspect. In case of a deferred consideration, okay, the taxability will be in the same year, or at least that's what it looks like, although representations have been made that this cannot be taxed in the same year because the person has not received it. Imagine receiving it over 3 years and paying tax in the first year. It's a non-starter. And in this COVID situation, these kind of deals will happen and there will be serious tax issues arising out of this. Incidentally, on FEMA, the deferral can be only for 25% for 18 months. So if the buyer is a company, is a foreign company, then this will become an issue under FEMA. To the extent it is envisaged that the consideration is beyond 18 months. Okay, that brings me to the, I think, the last slide, last case study, and then the conclusion. Again, something similar, that this is just a variant of that NCRPS kind of option, but here it is part consideration in cash and part in shares. So the original, and we are facing this situation. Agreed deal structure was, I will buy out your company, I will pay you the money, and that's the end of it. Now COVID has happened, I don't have the money. I can pay you partly in cash, partly by issuing bonds and redeemable preference shares. And are you willing to take it? In that particular situation, the seller will be out of pocket because he will pay tax on the whole thing because this is not a merger, it's just a buyout. So the value of the bond and the RPS, to my mind, will be considered as an upfront payment. And even though there is no monetization, one way of dealing with it is to potentially list the bonds and the RPS. And that's the point I wanted to come to. Even if buyer company is unlisted, the bonds can be listed and maybe sold at some discount to somebody, which can be a pre-agreed deal so that you get a discounted price for your sale, but at least you get the money. So that could be a possibility. And then you can pay the tax from that money. Just one other issue on tax. In the context of issue of bonds, if you are buying the shares of a company, there is this absurd provision in the proviso to section 57 now, which says that the interest deductibility, in which is in this case for the buyer company, will be only 20% of the dividend. Now it may not even get a dividend, and the dividend is anyway too small normally. So there could be a challenge in getting, unless the buyer's company says, I don't think I don't think that I am buying it as a non-strategic. I'm buying it as a strategic. So therefore, section 57 should not apply. I'm going to claim under 36. Again, this could become a controversy. But I just thought that I should, you know, point out, because many times section 57 proviso, you may forget. Remember that the earlier case law of Rajendra Prasad Moody in 115 ITR was that interest deductibility is full under section 57, even if you don't get a dividend or the dividend is minuscule. Okay, that let's go to the last one. I think there's Tanvi, can you change the slide or have I lost the connection?
We can hear you.
Okay. Tanvi, just go to the last slide, because it's showing a message here that the connection has been lost. So that's why. Anyway, the last slide, which is the summing up and the key takeaways. I'm not able to see the last slide. I'm not sure whether Tanvi has lost the connection, but basically it's just some takeaways and the four key takeaways that I want to just point out. It's not on your screen. Is the M&A contours are going to substantially change as a result of COVID, and we went through numerous examples of different instruments, deferred versus contingent, mergers and demergers instead of buyout, and that you need to understand that. And therefore, it's not just tax but other regulations as well. The second is, remember that structuring takes time, particularly if there is a scheme involved. It is better to start upfront rather than assume that things will happen at the last minute. I have seen countless deals that have collapsed because time has run out. And the third and the last one is something I said at the beginning, that you have to recognize that there is a trade-off in the CRT structure. And my practical experience of almost four decades is commercial reality will always override tax considerations. Regulations, of course, you have to deal with, but commercial reality will always take precedence over tax. And therefore, you have to balance. So if the commercial imperative is strong, you know, you may need to take a tax risk. With that, I will stop and don't know whether there is time to take questions, but happy to take. I finished in exactly 55 minutes, so I hope that's okay.
Thank you, sir. Ketan bhai, really an excellent session, and you could cover and explain things in such a easy manner by taking various case studies. And we are really grateful, Ketan bhai, and to you for sparing your valuable time to speak to such a large audience. So with that, I think Ketan bhai, on behalf of WIRC, I would want to thank you once again, and we are extremely grateful, and thanks a lot for the session, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Can I log off now?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
We are also joined by a chairman, Lalit Bajaj, and a regional council member, CA Balkishan. And we also have a central council member, CA Aniket Talati. Okay. In the meanwhile, may I request my colleague Balkishan to introduce our next speaker, CM Milin Mehta. Balkishan ji, over to you for the introduction.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much, Murtuja sir. Mr. Milin Mehta is a chartered accountant and is a senior partner of KC Mehta and Company Chartered Accountant for more than 3 decades. He is a fellow member of Institute of Chartered Accountant of India, and with bright academic record, he has secured rank in the merit list in the examination of ICAI and also secured gold medal in MCOM examination of MS University of Vadodara. In the professional practice, he is mainly engaged in the area of providing consultancy to various corporate and non-corporate bodies in the area of strategy, taxation, domestic and international, both merger, acquisition, joint ventures, etc. He has been strategic advisor to the several industrial groups. Mr. Mehta has also been invited as special invitee to the committee of ICAI representation before the Central Board of Direct Tax Standing Committee of the Parliament on formation of new Direct Tax Code. Mr. Mehta was also a member of the committee set up by Central Board of Direct Tax for framing tax accounting standards, which are renamed as Income Tax Computation Disclosure Standards. He was also a member of committee appointed by the Finance Minister under the CBDT for considering the MAT impact on introduction of Ind AS and also to notify further ICDS due to introduction of Ind AS. He has held the position of Treasurer and Vice Chairman of WIRC of ICAI. He has contributed a large number of papers in various seminars and conferences organized by professional organizations, although the country, and also contributed articles in reputed professional journals and magazines. Mr. Milind Mehta has been invited very often to make lectures in educational seminars. He has also co-authored a book on minimum alternate tax published by Bombay Chartered Accountants Society. He is also very active in social services as a past president of Vadodara Lions Club Educational Trust. Mr. Mehta worked is several reputed listed and unlisted private companies and independent professional non-executive director, and he is also trustee and member of governing body of some reputed NGO. So with this introduction, I request to all the members present here give virtual round of applause for our next speaker, Milind Mehta sir. Yes sir.
Milind bhai, over to you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you very much, Lalit ji, Murtuza, Balkishan, for a long introduction. I had specifically, while forwarding my biodata, I said that I'm too lazy to change my biodata. Please don't read it full. I feel extremely embarrassed when the whole thing is read. Now I'll have to invest some time in ensuring that my biodata is curtailed. So I think I have time. If I go by the schedule which is given, probably I have about 20 minutes. But I will, with your permission, I'll take some more time and try to finish off the things in as fast as possible.
Sir, take you.
So I know that in virtual, I don't know how many of you are participating. So I don't know. It's my risk, you know, by taking more time. So I have to be sure that I will be free by time. So let me show you my screen so that, you know, we can start immediately in respect of this part. Are you able to see? Because I am able to share, but somehow or the other file is not coming up. Are you able to see the screen?
Sir, we can see the screen now, and you will have to click on share.
I am doing on the share.
Okay. No, it has gone back.
So now it is shared.
Yes.
Yes, we can see now.
Only thing is that I have to show. You are seeing only your own faces. I need to share the PowerPoint. I don't know why it is not coming up.
We can see the PowerPoint.
No, I need to. Should I give you the? But somehow or other, I'm not been able to get into this. So I'm.
Minister,
I give it to WRT. I'm giving you the control. If you can just take the control, and I have given the control to WRC. If you can click on this one.
You'll have to mail also the PPT then.
So I'm on the.
Mishraji, email ID is there. We can see the slide now.
Milind sir, aap chhod dijiye, main kar raha hu.
Sure. I'll leave.
Continue.
So I still can't see the full this one, but I can't see the slide. I still see the videos.
So you'll have to go to the webcam.
Webcams, I'll see, stop. So always in front, I'll have to remove. Okay, now I get something. I'll have to minimize this, right? Okay, fine. So I can see this. Are you all able to see that, the slide? So, okay, friends, thank you very much for inviting me for this seminar. I'm very happy to share my thoughts in respect of taxation of expatriates in India. Is the second slide seen? Can you see the second slide now? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Are you on the broad? Okay. So the entire agenda which I proposed to cover was primarily the basics of expatriate taxation, the taxation of inbound expatriates, taxation of outbound expatriates, the social security contributions, and the social security agreements that India has got, the exchange control requirement and other compliances. I don't think so that the time is sufficient that I may be able to go through the whole thing. The primarily in respect of basic of expatriate taxation, that is the residential status, the Income Tax Act, the Double Tax Avoidance Agreement, the scope of total income, how does that work, especially considering the new changes which have been made in the residential status. In case of inbound expatriates who come to India, what are the different modes in which these agreements are taken into consideration, like assignment, direct employment, or a secondment, the tax and the withholding tax implications in that. I would be covering some typical examples and issues relating to expatriate taxations, including like short stay exemptions, taxation in respect of perks in case of ESOPs, then taxation of outbound expatriates, what happens, residential status, receipt versus accrual, because as you know, a lot of the expatriates which go to countries like Africa, their payments, significant payment come directly to their bank accounts, NRO accounts in India or NRE accounts in India. What happens to that sort of a taxation, whether that gets taxed on account of receipt. Then there is a very significant issue which happens in respect of expatriates, in respect of social security, because India has obligated that all international workers which come to India with a limit, without any limit, they would be required to contribute to the social security contributions. And if there is no SSA, there is the restrictions in respect of their ability to withdraw from SSAs. And then there are exchange control requirements, because in case if the monies are deposited here, whether they are allowed to take this money outside. And then there are other compliances, visa requirements, registration of foreigners, registrations, and various aspects in respect of the approvals and the compliances which are required to be done. So we will go and see stop it at a time when possibly the time is no longer sufficient for me to go forward. I'm going to leave this entire presentation to you, so that what can happen is that in case subsequently you can have a look at these presentations in respect of that. Coming to the expatriate taxation, what do you mean by an expatriate? An expatriate, we are looking at it from both angles. One is that a person who is based in a foreign country, maybe a citizen of India or a non-citizen of India, and now then comes to India for the purpose of working. That's an inbound expatriate. So we have a lot of companies which are MNCs which send their people from outside India for technical, for heading, for marketing, etc. And they are in India for a contract for 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, etc. And then they provide services in India and they go back to their base countries. So these are primarily the expatriates. We have persons who are based in India, which are likely Indian citizens. 99% these are all Indian citizens who are working and they go abroad for the purpose of taking up employment. Either it could be on an H-1 visa when they go to US, etc., or they go on a project, and or they get into Middle East or in Africa, etc. They go to different countries. So these are primarily the expatriates that we would be discussing about. The Indian Income Tax Act, you know, the incidence of tax, as you all know, depends on the residential status and the place and time of accrual of this income, right? So that's what, in case it is a non-resident, the income would not be chargeable to tax unless the income is accrues or arises to India, in India, or the receipt of such income is in India. Similarly, in case of India, the charge of income tax is generally not based on domicile or citizenship. Now, there is a major departure which was made in Section 6 of the Income Tax Act in this year, wherein they made earlier citizenship and Indian citizen got a favorable treatment under the Income Tax Act, wherein the restriction of being in India for more than less than 60 days, in case if a person was in India for more than 365 days in the immediately preceding 4 years, was not applicable, and for them it was 182 days. So one thing which has happened is that there is a curtailment which has been done, and second more important thing now which has been done, that an Indian citizen, like possibly to a certain extent like in US, an Indian citizen will be deemed to be an Indian resident unless he shows that he is liable to tax in any other country because of his domicile, residence, etc. So I think that is what is very important, that we need to keep it in mind that there is generally not based, but there is a change which has been made in respect of citizenship. The residential statuses that we have are the resident and the ordinary resident, resident and not ordinarily resident, and non-residents, right? These are the three primary status. And in case of expatriate taxation, these statuses become very, very important. And as you would see, the compliance obligation for an ordinarily resident is significantly high, apart from tax, apart from the obligations in respect of the payment of tax on a global income. Just look at a situation where there is an expatriate who comes to India on a period of 3 years of assignment. I will show you that in case if the things are not planned in a proper manner, then in the third year of his employment, he can become an ordinary resident. And if he becomes an ordinary resident, in that situation, he would not only be required to pay tax in India on worldwide income, but even under the foreign assets declaration, he will also have to make a declaration in respect of all his foreign assets, including the bank accounts which are maintained outside India, which can create a significant amount of difficulty or probably discomfort to the next expatriate who comes to India. So planning of this, etc., these statuses are very important. Even the status under the FEMA is required is very relevant because of ability to repatriate money outside India is very important, and therefore the FEMA status is also required to be seen. And as you see that unlike Income Tax Act, FEMA clearly follows welcoming, considering a person as a resident, the only criteria is 182 days. There is no other criteria for treating a person as a resident in India. When you are talking about resident outside India, there is a couple with respect to an intention to stay outside India. That is what happens, and therefore a person can become a non-resident even in the middle of the year. Coming to the next slide, the Section 6 broad summary is primary criteria is 182 days in India. Is a general criteria for being a resident of India. An alternate criteria is that if you are in India for 60 days or more in a year, plus 365 days in immediately preceding 4 years, that's an alternate criteria, then also you become a resident of India. The alternate criteria does not apply to an Indian citizen leaving for employment, or if an Indian citizen or a person of Indian origin with Indian sourced income, less than rupees 15 lakhs, you know, if he comes on a visit to India and being out of India. So that's what, so if a person is out of India, being out of India, comes on a visit, and if he does not have an income, does not have income in India, Indian sourced income of more than 15 lakhs or more, in that situation, this alternate criteria does not apply to him. He would be still governed by 182 days. Similarly, an alternate criteria is modified to 120 days to Indian citizens or person of Indian origin having Indian source income exceeding rupees 15 lakhs. So if your income in India, Indian source income is more than 15 lakhs, then this 182 days is curtailed to 120 days, or the extension from 60 days is available only to the extent of 120 days. Similarly, an Indian citizen having an Indian sourced income in excess of rupees 15 lakhs, he will be always treated as a resident of India with effect from assessment year 21-22. And always resident unless liable to tax in any other country or territory by reason of his domicile or residence. And liable to tax is a concept which could be a matter of debate in respect of, especially in respect of some of the country which do not levy tax in respect of the individuals. He would be always treated as a not ordinary resident so long as he is not in India for more than 182 days, etc. So he will be treated as a not ordinary resident. There is a controversy which I will not get into in respect of the way in which the definition has been carried out. the not ordinary resident category. So now once you are a resident, there is a need to examine whether you are an ordinary resident or a not ordinary resident. And the criteria is that in case if you are satisfying any one of these two conditions, any one of these three conditions, in that situation, you will be considered a not ordinary resident. A non-resident means if you are in India for not more than 9 out of 10 years, you have to be non-resident in 9 out of 10 years. In that case, you are classified as a not ordinary resident. Or if you are in India in less than 730 days in immediately preceding 7 years, and or you are between 120 days and 182 days in case of Indian citizens. So this is what is the broad criteria of a person of Indian origin. In that situation, you will be treated as a not ordinary resident. You should always keep it in mind that a residential status, in case if a person belongs to a country where there is a treaty, double tax avoidance treaty, in that case, the residential status will also have to be examined. Even if a person becomes a resident under the Indian Income Tax Act, under by applying Section 6, you can also see in case if he remains as a non-resident under the treaty, in that situation, you should look at these provisions. What we have done is that we have tried to pick up Article 4 of OECD model draft. Of course, you will have to see every treaty from where that person belongs or where there is a residential status is required to be seen. You will have to pick up that treaty for the purpose of examining whether he is treated as a resident in India or not. The resident in a contracting state, generally it says that it would be as per the laws of that particular state. And that could be either on account of domicile, residence, place of management, or any other criteria of a similar nature. And that's what is the way in which the OECD defines. So the primary condition is in respect of a person is treated as a resident if he is treated as a resident as per the domestic laws. But it does not cover a not ordinary resident is not treated as the resident of a country under the DTAA. Because as per the Indian laws, which says that if a person is liable to tax in that state, in respect of only of income from sources in that state. And that is what we say that Indian sourced income is the only scope of total income for that person, then he is not treated as a resident. So theoretically, a person who is a resident but not ordinary resident would become a non-resident when it comes to DTAA countries, most of the countries, except where there are some exceptions which have been created. Similar definition could be there in case you have a non-domiciled UK. A person with a non-domiciled resident in UK, that a person is also liable to be taxed in UK in case if he has opted for an option, then he will be only liable to be liable to tax only in respect of UK sourced income or income which has brought in UK. So in that situation, that also would not be would not be entitled to be treated as a resident of UK. The OECD draft also provides that most of the treaty provides that in case because of some reason, a person is treated as resident of both the countries, in that situation, a tiebreaker test is required to be applied. And tiebreaker test means that if he's resident of both the countries, then which country that he should be considered as a resident, then there are additional tests which are applied. And these are the tests are like where that person has a permanent home available, where there is his personal and economic interest, which we call it the center of vital interest, is situated, where he has an habitual abode. Where does he, you know, that's a habitual abode, what is his normal place of residence, etc. What is his nationality and what, in case if none of these criteria is able to decide that one of the country is his residence, in that situation, the competent authority would decide. Now, these tests are to be applied sequentially in accordance with the respective treaty. OECD treaty is not a treaty, it's a model draft. You have to see at each and every treaty in case if a person, if the question is to be decided between India and UK, you have to decide about the treaty of Indo-UK treaty and then apply the tests which are complied in this. So tiebreaker test is required to be applied. There is a very interesting concept which we are generally not aware, and this could be very, very important when it comes to some of the treaty countries, wherein there is, we call it as a split residential, split residency. And this is covered in a way by in para 10 of the OECD draft commentary and on Article 4, wherein what they say that a person can be treated as a resident for some part of the year, whereas a non-resident for the balance part of the year. Now, that's what is the provision in treaty, and that can happen. Now, just to give you an example, that a person who, and this is very important from an angle that a person, because India follows financial year, say for example, I go to US and I go to US on 1st of July and I am in US for the rest of the time. In that situation, I would have completed, or say for example, I go on 1st of July, in that case, I have almost put about 9 months in US. So I become resident of US and I remain as, because since I have done about 6 months in India, I would also be treated as a resident of, since I have done more than 60 days in India, let's take a situation that I am not entitled to the benefit of the being an Indian citizen. In that situation, I would also be treated as a resident of India. So if I am a resident of India in both the countries, but my center of vital interest has moved from first July from India to US, in that situation, till 30th June, I'll be treated as a resident of India because my center of vital interest was in India till then. And from 1st of July onwards, since I would be a split, so there would be a split residency and the tax laws can apply accordingly. That is a very interesting concept. The some of the decisions to which I will be making a reference later on has considered this as an aspect and treated it on that basis, which is a concept which is novel, and Indian Income Tax Act does not recognize. Indian tax laws, Indian Income Tax Act provides that the tax residency is required to be determined with respect to the year entirely. There cannot be a split residency. So the scope of total income, if you look at it in case of a resident and not ordinary resident, on the worldwide income, non-residents are taxed only in respect of income which accrues or arises or is deemed to accrue or arise in India, or income that is received or is deemed to be received in India. So that's the scope of income for a non-resident. And for the purpose of not ordinary resident, the scope is exactly the same as non-residents. But in case if the income which accrues or arises outside India, but if it is from a business controlled from or a profession set up in India, in that situation, that also becomes chargeable to tax in the hands of a resident, but a not ordinary resident. Now, just a very brief idea about the taxation of salaries in the context in which we are talking about. A brief idea about this aspect would be that income arising on account of employee-employer relationship is only taxable as salary, and it includes salary allowances, perquisites, and all sorts of things, including retirement benefit, profits in lieu of salary, income on termination of employment. The whole scope is included as part, and there are no separate rules for the purpose of taxation of expatriates. The income of the expatriate is also required to be included exactly in the same way in which you will calculate the income of an Indian employee for the purpose of carrying out. The only important part is that employer-employee relationship is required to be established, and only in such situation that it be considered as a salary. Income of the salary shall be deemed to accrue or arise in India if it is earned in India. Section 9 provides that in case if it is earned in India, then only it would be treated as accruing or arising in India. And earned in India would mean that in case if the services are rendered in India and rest period and leave period which is preceded and succeeded by services rendered in India and which forms part of the contract of employment. This is primarily in respect of persons who come to India for the purpose of providing services. There is a rest period, so 15 days they are in India, 15 days there is a leave period, and that's for 15 days they are in India, 15 days they go back to Nepal or they go back to some other country. In that situation, even the rest period, even if it is spent outside India, would be treated as services rendered in India in respect of this period, in case if the contract provides for this period. A very interesting situation is going to be arising, and that's a question which is baffling me, and I'm sure that all of you should think about it. Now, we have been, because of COVID-19, and you know, I think Ketan B made a lot of reference to COVID-19. I should also make reference to COVID-19. Now, COVID-19 has taught us something like work from home. And almost everyone is thinking on work from home. And when we are talking about work from home, whether my home is in Baroda or whether my home is in Bombay or is in Dubai, it hardly makes a difference, right? Because ultimately the question is that if I have to sit across the laptop or I have to sit across an electronic instrument for the purpose of providing services. Now, it could be anywhere in the world and I can still continue to provide services. Now, the question here is that in case if there is a person who I decide that, okay, I am doing a job and my company allows me to do work from home, if I move myself to Dubai and start providing services from Dubai, The question here is, and in case if the remuneration remitted to me in Dubai, in that situation, whether it would be considered to be services rendered in India or the services rendered outside India. The general consensus is that so my physical location is very important, rather than the place where the services are provided or the place where the services are utilized. So I have been in UAE, and from UAE, if I'm providing services in that situation, it could still be considered as a services rendered from UAE or in UAE, though of course the utilization of those services because of electronic means could be in India. So, and if the recipient is entitled to the benefit of DTAA with any country, then the provisions of DTAA will have to be seen for the purpose of determining the scope of taxation of salaries. So it is very important that you need to also see the DTAA for the purpose of considering the scope of total income in respect of the salary income. Now, I already mentioned that there is, except with an exception of short service exemption, the income of the expatriate is also required to be calculated in the same way like we calculate the taxation on respect of this. Now, my first topic is taxation in respect of inbound expatriates. Friends, I think there is a lot of things which are happening, and I must point out that there is a big traction which is happening in respect of expatriates moving to India for the purpose of taking up employment. And especially for a small city like Baroda that we talk about, even we would have a significant amount of expatriates who work in India, in Baroda. The reservation which people used to have in respect of ability to move to India or desire to move to India or readiness to move to India has significantly going down. And people, more and more people are ready to move to India. And once they move to India, they find the environment so conducive for them because they get all sorts of help which is available in India. And that is the reason why they are more and more people are ready to come to India for the purpose of getting as an expatriate. And therefore, this topic of taxation of expatriates, inbound expatriates, is very important for us. And it's also turning out to be a very important area of practice. So, and this requires some special knowledge and some sort of an experience in providing these services. So in case if you have some sort of an experience, an opportunity to gather experience, please do not miss out, because this is going to be developed into a very, very important area of providing services. And we should make ourselves ready for the purpose of ensuring that all the laws which are related, and there are some typicalities in respect of expatriate taxation that we should be aware about, including their compliances obligations. Primarily, there are three models. I'm just talking about three models. I'm just going, and at the end of this topic of inbound taxation, inbound expatriates, I'll also deal with some few other models which are available. But these are the three primary models that we see. The first one is the secondment model, which is an economic employer model, wherein the person continues to be employed by some company. And these are all models which are very common when it comes to the cases where there is a subsidiaries which are in India of a foreign company. So a foreign multinational which has got a subsidiary in India, the person from one of the locations of the holding company or one of the group, that person can be seconded to India for the specific need of the Indian company. And he would come for the purpose of discharging certain obligations, certain functions in India. Like say, for example, we have a company in India, a Japanese company in India. The marketing head of that Japanese company is is deputed from Japan, and he heads that marketing division. Now these persons come on a contract to India, and that's a secondment which happens. Now secondment, and I'll go to the next slide when I tell you about how the secondment works. But the economic employer becomes the Indian entity, whereas the legal employer still continues to be a foreign entity. And this is done by way of a tripartite agreement in respect of this aspect. But the employee, the salary and everything is paid by the Indian employer. There's a deputation, wherein what happens is that the person continues to be on the role of the foreign employer. And he comes on a visit to India, and he is deputed to the work which is carried out. Now, these are very important from the angle there, especially when there are some services are to be rendered to an Indian entity. And like, say, for example, there is a commissioning activity which is carried out, and the commissioning activity is going to go on for a period of 6 months, 9 months, 1 year, 2 years. And there is a person who is put in charge of the entire commissioning activities. in that situation, a person is deputed from foreign country, and that person continues to be on the role of the foreign company, is only deputed, and the services are paid for as either a fees for technical services or a reimbursement of expenses to the foreign company for the purpose of providing services of this person. So this, the person individually does not have any direct relationship with an Indian employer, but this is done by way of a deputation model. Even in case of foreign technical collaborations also, there are technicians which are sent to India for the purpose of helping the Indian entity for setting up the processes. In such type of situations also, there are deputations which do take place. The person comes here to India, and certain costs are borne by the Indian entity for the purpose of their day-to-day expenses, and rest of the expenses are paid by the foreign entity. But the services are provided in India. There are new concepts which are coming up with the direct fresh employment. We just got recently, you know, we were working in respect of an employment, and these are very complex situations which can happen. It's not a very simple thing. It can happen. There is a French fellow who was to be employed by an Austrian company for the purpose of providing services in India for an Indian subsidiary. An Indian subsidiary would wanting to directly employ that person was to be directly employed. The question was that French fellow would work partially in the German lab of that person and Indian labs. You know, he was developing some sort of a process. Now the question here would arise is which place that he would get deputed, whether he would be employed in India, whether he would be employed by the German entity, whether he could be employed by the Austrian entity, how the whole thing would happen. But in the end, finally, it was decided that person would be directly employed by the Indian entity, and the Indian entity would make the payment, including his social security contributions, and then that person would work at the different locations for the purpose of providing services. So there are direct employment, especially in case of software companies. When you see, there are a lot of companies where the software companies directly employ people from expatriates as their employees on their role. Even that person can come from outside India, and that person can be there as an Indian employee of that entity. So there is also something which is not very uncommon, and this could be either for a short term or for a long term purposes. Just to give you an example of the secondment model, what is the transaction mechanics, how does it work? There is a foreign company, and foreign company enters into a tripartite agreement with the Indian employer, Indian host country, and the employee. So these three persons enter into a tripartite agreement wherein the secondment is provided to the Indian entity. Indian entity agrees to make the payment. Indian entity agrees to reimburse to the foreign company the social security contributions which are made by the foreign employer. And that is what is the agreement which is done. There are times where secondment fees are also paid to the foreign company in respect of these aspects. And the employee, thereafter, there is a fresh employment agreement under the secondment agreement is entered into with the inbound expatriate. And that is the way that gives the right to the Indian, to the expatriate for the purpose of taking availing of all benefits from the Indian entity. And so this is how the whole secondment model works. Either there is a direct payment to the employee, or there is a payment which is made to the foreign company and reimbursed completely on a rupee to rupee basis to the foreign company. Either of the two things which happen. In such a situation, the employment with the foreign company remains the dormant employment. Indian company is the economic employment, bears the entire salary cost, and Indian company is responsible for the acts and omissions and the control of the employment of the expatriate. So this is generally the arrangement which is done in respect of secondment. Every MNC group would have their own secondment policies, and it could be different in different countries, including case of insurance, including in case of the perquisites, tax equalization, etc. But this is the general way in which we have tried to depict, in which would be applicable in quite a large number of cases. Now, the taxation implication in such type of cases is salary income of expat would be taxable in India, because the services are rendered in India during the period of stay, irrespective of his residential status. So even if he is a non-resident, even in the year in which he comes or the year in which he goes outside India, he would still be treated as a resident of India. Since the services are rendered in India, it is deemed to accrue or arise in India. And therefore, even if he is treated as a non-resident or a not ordinary resident, that salary would continue to be taxed in India. The Indian company is required to deduct tax under Section 192 on the salary paid, even if the salary is dispersed outside India. So even if the foreign company makes a payment of this, there is a requirement for deducting tax under Section 192 from this salary. either Indian company or the foreign company will have to discharge that obligation for the purpose of making the payment of tax. The payment against salary by the Indian company should be treated as a reimbursement. So Indian company, say for example, the arrangement is such where the foreign company is reimbursed the tax from the Indian company. In that situation, the reimbursement, because the salary is already subjected to tax in India, for which the withholding tax has been paid under Section 192. The question is whether any amount which is paid, because in case the salary is disbursed by the foreign company, whether reimbursement of cost which is done to the foreign company, whether it would be treated as a fees for technical services, and if it is treated as a fees for technical services, whether it would amount to a, whether there would be a further requirement for withholding tax for the foreign payments. In our view, honestly speaking, we would take a view that since it has already been subjected to tax as salary, and it is not a fees for technical services, it's actually a reimbursement of salary cost only. In such a situation, FTS should not apply. However, I must point out that in case of Centrica of India Offshores, 44 Taxman.com 300 Delhi, High Court has taken a view that it amounts to a fees for technical services because it makes available the technical know-how to the Indian entity. So there are issues which are there, but I personally believe that it's a case where it should not have WHT withholding tax implications in respect of that. The GST liability also will not arise because it is reimbursement. It's not supply of services, but it is given in the course of employment, and therefore it is outside the scope of GST. Employee and the employer both are liable for contribution to PF. Employer is liable to contribute his 12%, and employee is required to deduct tax, 12% from his salaries, and that would go and contribution by PF unless there is a social security agreement and the certificate of coverage is obtained by the employee. He would still be liable to pay the social security contribution in India. There may not be any PE exposure because, you know, what happens? There is a concept of a service PE, as we say, that in case if a foreign entity provides through its employees in India any service in India, then those employees itself can constitute a service PE as a concept. Now, this would not constitute a service PE because these employees are at the full disposal of the Indian company. They don't provide services for and on behalf of the foreign company. These becomes effectively the employees of Indian company, and therefore it should not constitute a PE in India, and therefore there is no exposure of PE in respect of these persons in India. Again, for that, you can make a reference to the decision in case of Centrica India Offshore. The deputation model is where the foreign company is paid the fees for technical services, and then there is a service agreement with an Indian company, either on account of managerial services or technical services or supervision services, commissioning services, anything which could be done, which could be the services which would be provided under an independent agreement. There is no linkages with respect to employees. There is no linkages with respect to the employee salaries, but the persons are deputed by the foreign company to the Indian job for the purpose of providing services to Indian entity under a separate agreement which they have done it with the Indian entity. So these are all deputy. The continuity of employment is with the foreign company. The liability to make payment of the remuneration is also with the foreign company. Foreign company becomes the employer and it bears the cost. What it gets is a right to receive the compensation under a separate agreement with the Indian company. And a foreign company is responsible for acts and responsible, and therefore he is the full-fledged employer in respect of this. However, you must always remember that the concerned employee provides services in India because he is deputed to India and he is providing services in India. The question that is the what is the tax liability? Salary income of expat would still continue to be taxed in India because the services are rendered in India. So therefore, irrespective of his residential status, irrespective of the fact that he continues to be an employee of the foreign company, he would still be liable to pay tax in India in respect of his amount. In this case, since the economic employer is a foreign company, the liability to tax, including all the obligations for filing e-TDS returns, etc., would be on the foreign company. They will have to deduct tax at source, and that for which you can make a reference to the decision in case of Eli Lilly, where 312 ITR Supreme Court decision, where they have said that even if the economic employer outside, so long as the services are rendered in India, the foreign employer is required to deduct tax at source or from that amount. Now, there is a very important aspect that there is a very high level of PE exposure in India. because there is a fixed base which is available by for to these persons in India for providing services in India. So even if these persons are working in India, in that situation, those persons themselves can constitute a service fee in India. And therefore, subject to, of course, you have to see the DTAA provisions. Now, say, for example, if you have something which is happening from a service fee concept may not be there in many of the DTAAs. But in case if there are DTAA provisions which give an exposure to the service fee, in that situation, there could be a service fee exposure. And if it amounts to a service fee, in that situation, there is a significant amount of high amount of withholding tax liability on the payments which are made to the foreign entity, because then it is made to a foreign company for a fees for technical services in India. And by virtue of Section 44DA, there would be a withholding tax liability which could go as high as 40% plus plus, in subject to, of course, the DTAA of the respective countries. And in case if there is no PE, in that case, this amount can be liable to pay tax and under Section 115A as a fees for technical services at 10% plus plus, subject to the DTAA rate. In case if DTAA provides for the lower rate, in that situation, there could be a lower rate applicable. There would be also a GST implication, because this would be services which are provided by the foreign company in India. So it could amount to, on a reverse charge mechanism, it would amount to like an import of services, and the GST would be payable in respect of this amount. There would not be any social security liability in India. So because this person is not employed by an Indian enterprise, that person would not qualify as an international worker under the Provident Fund Act, and therefore there would not be requirement for making any Provident Fund contribution. And that's the reason why this could be, to a certain extent, in some cases, it could be very beneficial to the employer and the employee, because this amount does not go for social security contribution. There are some other models to which I would just make a reference, is that there used to be a model which was very done by some of the multinationals, which used to maintain good number of floating expatriates, senior level people that they used to maintain, and these people would be placed as MDs, executive directors, full-time directors in different countries at different bases, on the basis of the need which is arising. And those persons, a company would be incorporated, what we call it as the pool company, employee pool company, in Singapore, in UAE, in Hong Kong, etc. They will set up a company like this, and all these employees would become the employees of that company. There is requirement for disbursement of salary, etc. And then they would be seconded from that company or deputed by that company to different jurisdictions. No, that is what is the way in which it was done. However, it is not very, it's not a very popular model any longer, but there used to be a pool companies which are done. And then these are persons who are, there could be an implications on account of fees for technical services, PE, place of effective management, in case if there is a service company which is set up in Singapore and all the employees of those companies are deputed to business in India. In that case, there could be a situation in case of POEM of such thing, of that company in India, and that company itself can be treated and taxed in respect of its income in India. So there are issues which are there in respect of expatriate pool company, but this is something which was done. And this can be also examined some very specific cases. We still have expatriate pool companies for outbound expatriates, because especially in a case of an EPC company which provides services in several countries, in that situation, they do maintain an expatriate pool company in a jurisdiction where it is permitted, especially like, say, for example, in Middle East, or they provide such type of, in case of oil and gas, it used to be Singapore, where they would provide an expatriate pool company, and those employees from one project in one country, they would go to another project in another country, and they will continue to remain employed by a subsidiary which is formed in one of these countries. So this is what is possible in case of expatriate, but now also because of the FATCA and various KYC norms, and most of the countries are coming up in respect of various obligations, it is becoming more and more difficult for the purpose of getting such type of pool companies which are being set up. Instead of direct employment, there could be a consulting agreement which can be done. In case of a consulting agreement, especially when you look at the short-term engagements that is done, there is a provision in respect of independent professional services or independent personal services under the DTAA, depending upon the country from where that person is coming for the purpose of providing services. And if he's an independent engineer, there could be a case where you can probably work in respect of a consulting arrangement. That also is possible. However, there could be an issue of PE, POEM, fees for technical services, and so many other things which are required to be seen. But that's also some of the things where people have defined a relationship not as an employment, but as a consulting arrangement in respect of these aspects. There could be distinctive advantage in respect of that, especially when the employment and engagement is not going to be for a very long period of time. I will now quickly go into some of the scenarios. I will take another probably only 10 minutes and then I will stop because my slides are 56 and I do not intend to go to 56 or probably more. I do not intend to go there. Possibly we may have some continuity some other time. So scenario one, the part payment of salary, which is done by the foreign company and part by the Indian company. So there are times where an employee continues to be an employee of two persons, Indian company and the foreign company. Part salary is paid by the Indian company and part salary is paid by the foreign company. Now, in this situation, what is most important that whether in case of this employment, which is exercised, who is treated as an employer, whether the foreign company is treated as an employer or an Indian company is treated as an employer. It is very important to determine because in case if it is treated that he is a employee of the Indian company, in that situation, the entire liability in respect of withholding tax, etc., would be on the Indian company and it would be treated as a salary. And in case if it is a foreign company, in that case, responsibility and liability to deduct tax, etc., would be on the foreign company. Now, evaluation of control will have to be done on the basis of few criteria. There are no defined rules in respect of that, but considering various decisions which are applicable in respect of the way in which the employer-employee relationships are examined, who is the person who has got a better control and supervision on the employee, whether responsibility of work of the employee lies on whom. So whether in case if he makes an error, who is held liable in respect of that part, who has the right to take the decision in respect of continuity of employment, whether the right remains with the Indian entity or the foreign entity, who can regulate the terms and conditions of the employment. Now, whether employment conditions are free to be used by the Indian entity or the foreign company, who cost of salary and the social security, the meager distribution of, you know, honestly speaking, disbursement of remuneration by the foreign company cannot be a cost borne, etc. And the control over the selection and identification of the expat are all things which will have to be seen. And based on that, we will have to evaluate whether he continues to be an Indian company's employee. And in case if he continues to be an Indian company's employee, in that case, withholding tax liability would apply in respect of that person's employment. Whether the amount is paid and then the entire amount would be payable for this purpose, even if some portion of the employment is disbursed. So some portion of employer remuneration is disbursed in foreign country, but if the services are provided in India, in that situation, he would still be liable to pay tax in India in respect of his entire remuneration. The salary too is the salary borne by the foreign company without there being any cross charge to the Indian company. So there are cases where the person provides services to India, but there is no cross charging which is done by the Indian company. The salary is completely borne. There could be a separate arrangement. Like, let's take a situation that there is a case where the Indian company is carrying out a job work in respect of a foreign company. But for the purpose of ensuring that the Indian company continues to maintain an extremely good quality control, they depute a person to India for the purpose of ensuring that all quality control, safety, and other measures are borne by the Indian company, which we call it as a stewardship activity is carried out in India. And supervision, and they carry out the supervision in respect of this work. In such a situation, though the person is in India, the services are rendered for the foreign company and there are no cross charges which are done to the Indian company. So in that situation, the foreign company shall be regarded as the legal and the economic employer. And the key aspects is expats work under the control of the, though of course he works under the control and supervision of the Indian company, Indian company is responsible, but the employee retains the title with the foreign company and foreign company pays to the salary and there is no cross charge which is made to the Indian company. So foreign company continues to be the legal employer. Arrangement is identical to the deputation. The withholding tax is to be done by the foreign company on the 100% of the salary, including the perquisites. So even if under the contract of employment, that person is required to be provided accommodation in India, even that accommodation would be considered as a part of an accommodation provided as a part of the service. And that's the reason why he would be also required to deduct tax on the perquisites which are so provided. And since the expat works in India on behalf of the foreign company, implication with respect to the PE also will apply, and we will have to see. And if there is no cross charge in that situation, there could be an implication from the transfer pricing perspective, especially in case of a foreign employer, because in that country, since he is providing services to India without any cross charge, we'll have to link it as to why that person is providing services in case it is providing services to the Indian entity without any cross charge. There is a scenario three, manpower supply service provider. There are cases where the services are provided by the manpower supply company, wherein the persons are selected and then they are provided. They continue to remain the employee of the foreign company. They are seconded by the foreign company. And this is similar to pool company, but here we are talking about a third party manpower supply company and not the internal pool company. So these are the persons, companies which are specialized in respect of providing specialized manpower. And these persons do provide manpower to various entities, and they provide services to many companies. And they are seconded to by the foreign company to the Indian company. There is a specific qualifications and the expertise requirement. They continue once it is seconded to India. During that period of time, they become the employee of the Indian company. Salary is paid by the Indian company, and foreign company is paid for the recruitment charges. So, for example, $100,000 is paid as a salary to a person. $10,000, $15,000 or $20,000 is paid as the recruitment charges for the purpose of till such time that person continues to be in employment. Employee works under the supervision of Indian company. The Indian company is liable to be deduct tax from the salary, and this entire amount becomes chargeable to tax. Very low chance in respect of it being treated as the fees for technical services, except the recruitment charges that can, in some of the agreements, if it is a management services, it can still qualify as the fees for technical services. Otherwise, it may not amount to a fees for technical services. There may not be a PE issue because those persons are at the disposal of the Indian company and they don't provide services for and on behalf of the foreign entity. And that's the reason why there may not be a PE issue in respect of that. I've already covered the case of dual employment, where the person part of the year provides services to India and part of the year he provides services. To the extent that person provides services in India, to that extent, the amount would be chargeable to tax in respect of those amounts in India, irrespective of the period for which he is paid salary. Whoever pays, whatever period that he provides services in India, this would be chargeable to tax in India. There is an interesting issue which can arise in respect of ESOPs. And what can happen is that there are so many persons who come to India on a secondment basis. The entire salary income which is chargeable to tax in India is to be computed, and India does levy tax on the ESOPs. The question that arises is, say, for example, there is a person who comes to India on a three-year term, and during this three-year term, there is a vesting happens, and thereafter the person exercises that option, and then the shares are allotted. Now, under Section 17, allotment of shares is a taxable event. And therefore, the difference between the fair market value and the exercise price, that becomes chargeable to tax in this year. Now, the question here is that he's a person who is resident in India. He is a person who is chargeable to tax in respect of services which are rendered in India. This is an income which becomes chargeable to tax as per the Indian law in the current year, because the option is exercised in the current year, whether he is liable to pay tax on this entire amount or not. This matter came before the Delhi High Court, Delhi Tribunal, in case of Robert Arthur Kells, and where it was decided that in case if there is an amount which becomes taxable, only that portion of the amount which is pertaining to the services which are rendered in India would be chargeable to tax. Now, just to give you a very quick idea about the ESOP, ESOP is granted. Thereafter, there is a vesting period. Now, vesting period could be 1 year, 2 years, 5 years, 7 years, 10 years. It could be any number of years. Now, after the vesting, there is the shares are vested, and then there is an exercise period in which a person has to exercise. And once he exercises, there is an allotment which is done in respect of those shares by the employer. The taxable event in India is the allotment of shares, though, of course, the valuation is to be done on the date of exercise. But the allotment is the date on which the amount becomes taxable. What it says that even if there is an amount which is taxable, out of, say, for example, total vesting period was 4 years, out of which 1 year this person has provided services in India, then only 1/4 of the total amount of ESOP, which is chargeable to tax, would become chargeable to tax in India and not the whole amount. And that's what this decision provides. Similarly, there could be, now the question that arises, say, for example, in this case, the event occurred, the allotment occurred in the year in which that person was chargeable to tax in India. Now, what happens that he has provided services for 3 years in India, he has not done any exercise during that period, he goes back to his host home country, and after that, after about 1 year, he exercises this the ESOP. In that situation, whether the government can say and say that, look, this becomes a taxable event, and out of this taxable event, 3 years you have provided services in India, and therefore 75% of something which becomes taxable in the subsequent period, we will tax you. According to me, so long as once that person is no longer providing services to India, Section 17 would not apply. And since the taxable event has not occurred during the time when the person was providing services in India, in my view, it would be difficult for the government to bring to tax something which was not taxable during the time when he was providing services in India. However, this is a toss of a coin, but I am strongly of the view that it may not become chargeable to tax in India. I will quickly talk about the short stay exemption. Now, short stay exemption, which is given in India under two alternative. One is under Section 10(6)(6) of the Income Tax Act, which exempts a service. And there is also a benefit which could be available under the DTAA, where also they call that in case the services are provided for a shorter period, in that situation, it would not be chargeable to tax in India. There are certain conditions in respect of that. I will not get into those conditions, but we need to examine that in case if the employment is exercised for a very short period, we need to examine the DTAA, and in case all the conditions are satisfied, and one of the major conditions in that remuneration should not be borne by an Indian enterprise or an Indian entity or from the taxable income in India. So long as that condition is satisfied and the period of service is within those thresholds, in case under Income Tax Act of 90 days and in case of DTAA, it is 183 days. In that situation, the short period exemptions which are available. There are other exemptions under Section 10(6) applicable in specific cases of embassy, consulate, trade representations, etc. I'm not going into those parts of that. Let me deal with some very typical issues. And I think this is the last slide that I can take because I'm already at 34 minutes away from what I should have stopped. I will just go to some typical issues. The first is the case of split residency. I've already told you about the split residency. I think it is incorrect for you to come to a conclusion that a person, you know, in case, especially in respect of the international tax and when you apply DTAA, it may be a good idea for you to examine whether you can apply this principle in respect of part of the year where a person could be considered as a resident of India, whereas as a part of the year, he would be considered as a non-resident. Now, very important, and I will just come to the next point here to explain to you what could be the problem. You know, say for example, you have to be very careful about when you are deciding about an expatriate. It is very important that the timing of his arrival and timing of his departure and the period has to be very, very carefully decided. And let me give you an example here. Now, let's take a situation of a person who is in India and he comes to India for example, 1 year where he completes 270 days. So he comes in the first quarter. So he becomes a resident. But since he is coming to India for the first time, this is the year in which he becomes a resident, but he becomes a not ordinary resident. So he's still subjected to tax in India only in respect of Indian sourced income. In the next year, he is in India for almost 365 days. So he is again being resident, but not ordinary resident because he has not neither completed 730 days in the immediately preceding year and preceding 4 years of 7 years, nor he has been resident in 9 out of 10 years. In the year after that, in the third year, where, you know, because these contracts are generally for 3 years. So in the third year, what would be his status? Now, if you look at the third year, he would be again 365 days in India, and therefore he would be treated as a resident, but he would still be treated as not ordinary resident, though he was resident for nine out, he was not a non-resident in 9 out of 10 years, But he had not completed 730 days in the immediately preceding 7 years. And that's the reason why he would be treated as a not ordinary resident. And say, for example, again, on the on 1st of July, in the year after that, he goes back to his home country. Now, when he goes back to his home country, now look at that year. He has done 90 days in India. So he becomes 90 days. He has completed 365 days in the immediately preceding 4 years. So in that year, he would be treated as a resident. Now, the question is that if you look at the other two conditions, he has already completed more than 730 days because he was 365 days in year three, 365 days in year two, and about 270 days in the year one. So if you look at it, he has already completed this 730 days in 7 out of 10 years. He has already been, he is not a non-resident in 9 out of 10 years because he was non-resident in 3 out of 10 years. So that's, he was a resident in 3 out of 10 years. So therefore, he will become, even though he is in India for only 90 days, he would become, so long as he is not a citizen of India, he would become actually an ordinary resident, and he would not only be liable to pay tax in respect of his Indian income in that year, he will also be liable, subject to DTAA, he will also be liable to pay tax on his worldwide income. He will not only be required, he will also have to make a disclosure in respect of his worldwide assets under the Schedule FA, which is filed, and there would be a lot of inconvenience. So you have to be extremely careful when you talk about these aspects. The second very interesting aspect is that there is a provision in the section 1010CC, which says very clearly that in case if the employer bears the tax under section 192.1A on non-cash perquisites, let's take a situation, a residential house has been provided, on that a perquisite value is calculated, on that the amount of tax is borne by the employer. In that case, to the extent of tax which is borne for the employer, there would not be any tax payable by the employee because that is exempted from tax. At the same point in tax, at the same time, the amount of tax which is borne by the employer is not allowed as a deduction in the hands of the employer. Right? So that's what, so they say that on that the tax would be borne, and on tax, whatever tax which is borne is not allowed as a deduction. So there is a facilitation which has been done. Now, especially in case of a non-resident employer, he is not going to take benefit or he's not going to take any deduction in respect of that. For them, taking benefit of section 1010CC would be very, very helpful because they are in any case not losing from on account of corporate tax, because they are either paying tax in India on a gross income or they are paying tax, they are not paying tax in India at all. In such a situation, it may be a good idea to take benefit of section 192.1A and section 1010CC in respect of these aspects. This could be very important from an expatriate taxation perspective. The social security contribution which is made outside India, there are a lot of issues which can come up, because when he is providing services in India, if the employer contributes to the social security obligations, say for example there are pension funds to which the employer is required to continue to contribute even under SSA or under a non-SSA condition, whether that contribution would become taxable in India, because there is no exemption which is available under Indian Income Tax Act. Exemption is available only if the employer contributes to certain funds. Now, this is not that certain fund, and therefore that can become taxable in India. Now, there is a decision in case of old decision L.W. Russell and thereafter Yoshio Kubo, where they say that there is no vested right at the time of contribution, and therefore it does not become taxable in the hands of the employee, even where the employer contributes to such type of pension funds at that point in time. Providing residential accommodation, you know, that could be a taxability in respect of that, and we need to see. There would be a very funny situation which can happen where a person is provided in a hostel accommodation which is owned by the employer. In that situation, there could be a very huge tax liability. In such a situation, it may be a good idea to recover the entire cost, so there is no concession which is provided to them. But even if there is a concession which is provided, even probably 7.5%, 10% or 15% of his salary can be considered to be chargeable to tax in his hands, especially when the hostel is owned by the employer. And that's the reason why you must always see to it that it is a rented accommodation. Cost of providing transport to the self and family and personal belongings at the commencement, the end. For the end, there is an exemption which is available, but these are all pertaining to India. The only argument which we can take is that this was an employment condition, so he has not received any benefit, and on account of that, it may not become chargeable to tax in India. But there could be a situation which can arise where he is required to bear the tax in respect of these type of expenses for these cases. Friends, I think there are a lot of more slides. I am very thankful to you all for the purpose of for sparing your time and giving me this opportunity. I'm sorry I could not finish this whole thing. I thought that it would be a good idea for me to at least prepare all the slides, which I can share it. You can have a look at it. I would be always available on email for the purpose of supporting any question that you may have in respect of these aspects. So thank you very much, and sorry for detaining you beyond 5 o'clock, which was the scheduled time. I don't know how many of you have still continued, but in case if you have continued, there is something which is which I have to. I am sure that you will all pardon me for that. So then, Murtada, back to you.
Thank you, Milind Bhai. So really, Milind Bhai, let me first thank all the. The last number which I can see now is 1210 still.
Yeah.
So 1200 people waiting till the end. Listen to each and every piece of it. Really grateful to each and every participant for their commitment, for their support, and for staying through. I know it is really difficult to accommodate 3 speakers in 3 hours. 1 hour is less. But then, like we wanted to cover like all the various topics, and Milind Bhai, really grateful. I know it got delayed by the time we gave it to you, but you could cover so well all various aspects of the inbound and outbound expat related issues, and like in where the contract, where how the arrangements can be done, giving practical views on multiple of them. I'm sure those all those will be quite beneficial to all the participants. So on behalf of WIRC, we are grateful and we thank you for your time. And I request all the participants to carry out a thank with a applause on their home. Milind Bhai, thank you once again.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you to all the participants, and thank you to all the WIRC staff as well.